Oh, what? You're out of control.
Dude, I was just about to do the intro. How am I out of control?
Go ahead. Go.
What is up with it, Super Smash Brothers Melee? This is Melee and On Me, episode 11. We're calling it the Melee Experience. Yeah, dude, it's episode 11 already. Are you kidding me? Last one was episode 10 about Sweden. Cactuar wasn't with us. Prague has been ever since he retired. So I'm your host, Scar. And with me today is Prague, the perennial pillar, Dr. Z, Joseph Marquez, a.k.a. Mango, and Cactuar. So what's going on, guys? We just got back from NCR. Mango, you want to start us off? I always put you after Sheridan. That's always a bad idea.
What do I say? You want to hear?
What have you been doing? What have you been doing since last time we talked, a.k.a. 2 weeks ago?
Yesterday was Fun Day Tuesday. We got pretty drunk, played Smash, played Mario Tennis.
Dude, who won Mario Tennis?
Dude, Johnny and Alex beat me and Joey and
Mario.
Because Joey started choking, dude. I was actually getting mad. I was getting so mad. He had the front, and everyone just kept getting balls past him like it was nobody's business, dude. I was like, oh.
What a buster. Dude,
and then,
who do you play? Yeah. Who do you think's the best at Mario Tennis?
Who do you think? I play Shy Guy, dude. He's the shittiest character. He's so bad, but I play him so that when I win, I can say I beat you with a shitty character.
Who does Joey play?
Joey plays Yoshi, dude, for life.
Who's Waluigi? Because he's definitely the best.
Dude, all the big characters are broken. They hit so hard, and they, like, hit at angles that, like, people like Shy Guy can't cover.
But I would have loved to see you getting mad at Joey for letting the balls past him.
Dude, he's, like, just all behind him, and I'm covering the other side, and he just hits it to that side and, like, just sneaks past Joey, and I'm like, oh.
Buster.
And then, we stayed up till 5. We woke up at 10, so I'm pretty tired. We went to a buffet, and, now I'm here.
Wait, are you serious?
What?
What kind of buffet?
Asian food. It's called hibachi. It's pretty good.
Oh, dude, hibachi's supposed to be amazing.
Yeah, and there's Mongolian food for, like, $8, so it's all good.
Sick.
And then that's my life, yeah.
Cactus, how have you been, dude? You haven't been on the show in, what, 2 months?
It hasn't been that long, has it?
How is the month of April for you?
It was pretty good. Did a little bit of training. I made a decision. I'm going to go to Evo. I think everybody should be making that decision.
I agree, yeah.
If not now, then soon.
Everybody should really sit and think, do I want to go to Evo? And I hope that the thought of, like, you know, do I want to donate to Evo, like, the response is pretty similar. I want to go to Evo. What else, Cactus? Evo. You excited to be in Vegas?
Who are you talking to right now, me?
Yeah, I said Cactus, so.
Oh, my bad. Yeah, I mean, last time I was there... I didn't hear that part. I was too busy watching Prague. But
yeah,
last time I was there was
the
last
episode. I just focused on that guy doing them curls.
I'm excited.
You gotta slow those curls down, though, man. You gotta just like that.
I don't know.
Like that, yeah.
We'll see how it goes. It should trump last time. That's all I'm hoping.
Yeah, you should listen to Sheridan, dude. He knows.
I know a couple of things.
He knows some hockey.
Sheridan, how have you been, man? Since 2 weeks ago.
Oh, yeah, pretty good. I've been spending most of this month, trying to write the paper for the journal that came out of my thesis, and B, trying to find somewhere to work in the near future, and just making all those, you know, kind of medium-term plans.
No.
And so I'm going to be moving out of Deep NorCal.
No!
Probably... probably like 3 or 4 weeks, I'll be moving back to Novato temporarily.
Okay.
And then we'll see what happens after that.
You're leaving NorCal?
I'm leaving Deep NorCal.
What is NorCal going to do without you? What are they going to do?
I don't know, man.
You're going to be
Is it possible that you stay in NorCal?
We got plenty of cool people in NorCal, though.
No. Everybody's leaving.
Yeah,
everybody's leaving.
Dude, Alan Tavakins is gone.
Right?
Alan and Julian... know how to do things.
Yeah. But where are you going to be?
I don't know.
I'll be
in Novato for a little bit. Then I don't know.
Are you looking around NorCal at all?
I'm open to it, but I didn't specifically look for NorCal.
I'm so nervous.
I would be open to SoCal too.
SoCal would be okay. I would be okay with you moving to SoCal. I'll allow it.
I'm sorry, Sheridan, you won't like it here, dude. Don't come.
You know what? I kind of feel like you might be right.
Our people, they won't mess with you.
I think you might be right.
Just don't do it. I'm warning you. We're cool, but we're not for you. You're too used to the NorCal family of love.
Yeah, we are a bunch of lovers up here.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. You might be right. Yeah, so.
Cool. Prague, what's up with you, dude? How have the past 2 weeks been?
Life has been pretty good. Yeah, I've been pretty good. Not too much going on. Work is the same. Been actually hitting the batting cages pretty recently.
Nice.
Trying to join the company softball team.
Amazing.
Get back in shortstop.
Dude, you're a shortstop.
Yeah,
man.
Couldn't
put you as a shortstop.
I wouldn't either.
For whatever quick, man. Reason. Quick on my feet.
Alright, well, we should play baseball.
And, Smash stuff. The production group is putting in a lot of work. I hope to have a grand reveal probably next week. A big shout out to everyone that's involved in those projects because, again, they're all volunteers and stuff. And putting together some really important stuff. And when the Twitter tirade yesterday about East Coast Smash, be sure to follow me and check my timeline to see who I yelled at. And if you think it refers to you, it just might be true. But keep posted. There's something in the plans that you guys definitely want to be on the lookout for. Something that's going to go ahead and break the current state of tournaments as they are currently seen in the Smash scene. So get ready.
Dude.
Scientology.
Dude, Prague, a bunch of people are saying that you look like Ness in the chat. That's actually super funny. Do you guys see the striped yellow shirt, the baseball cap? Amazing.
Definitely seeing it.
Definitely want to see it in the batting cages. All right, and I've been doing fine. The last thing that I did was
I don't think anybody asked you, Bobby.
I asked myself implicitly. It's actually like the last thing I did was NorCal Regionals. Woo! It's the first thing on the agenda. Here's a Google Doc. I linked it in the chat, and I'll link it on the video whenever I upload this video, hopefully today. I wanted to talk about NCR, man. That was a pretty big tournament. It was last Friday, all day Friday, which is so weird because we always do Saturday, Sunday tournaments. And we just played top 8 on Saturday. So who wants to start us off about NorCal Regionals? Sheridan or me? I know Mango doesn't.
I can talk about my experience running it.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, Sheridan, the main man, the TO. Did Tavikins back you up or what?
Yeah.
I know one person who didn't back you up. This guy. I didn't do any work at all.
Dude, okay.
I was technically staff, but I didn't do
I'm getting there. Get there at the venue at like 10 o'clock. I'm super busy setting up for like the next 2 hours. I'm sitting at my laptop, like pouring over these pools because I had like 4 lay people join that really needed seeds. And I had to figure out, you know, how to put them in there without disrupting all the regional stuff and everything. Meanwhile, the stream's not working. Uh-huh. I got people I'm waiting to get back to me on, you know, the network for the system. I've got a bunch of people come in with setups. You know, I got to figure out where to put them. Bobby comes along and he's like, "Hey, Sheridan, where can I play some video games?" I'm obviously like the most busy man in the universe right now. Just like sitting at the laptop like this, you know, just
you
like
were. You really
not
were.
Really, you know, having a good look on my face. And just in my moment of fucking, you know, despair.
When everything was crashing down on you.
Yeah, I was like, Bobby, that's not my problem.
Dude, I don't get
it. I was like, I didn't.
You said,
almost instantly regretted it, but that was the only way I knew how to concisely express.
Did you feel like you were scolded in that moment?
No, I understood it. I actually have similar stories where I was a TO. How about ROM 1? I don't want to put Alucard on blast, but I know for sure that I TO'd that tournament. I made pools. I actually did the setup day one. Like, the venue was. I strolled in at like 10:30 or whatever. And the venue was like, there were 2 TVs plugged in and like 40 people waiting in line to play friendlies. And like, meanwhile, there were 10 or 15 TVs. There were like 10 TVs not plugged in. So I was like, all right, here's what the floor plan is going to be, blah, 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 blah.
I remember.
Yeah, dude, it was out of control. but out of control.
He's an asshole yelling at everyone. I was so mad at you.
Yeah, I was. I yelled at everybody. And, you know, I finally, like, I ran, like, the first, I don't know, 3 or 4 hours of the tournament. And, like, you know, things are starting to slow down. Somebody actually had to go out to get me lunch. I hadn't eaten. And so Angry Scar, you know, Hungry Scar.
Was oh, dude, you don't want to mess with Hungry
Scar. He's making an appearance. So I finally sit down for the first time all day at, like, 3:30 to eat, like, some shitty KFC and fries. And, you know, immediately, I forget who it was, but it was, like, somebody pretty nice and, like, you know, harmless, maybe, like, tread to a crisp. He just, like, walked up to me at, like, the worst time possible and was like, well, hey, Scar, can I get one of those fries? Dude, I almost fucking strangled him. I almost killed him right there. I was like, I've been working all day. He got way too much for, like, for the transgression. It was, like, such a little thing. And I went off.
I feel like that was me.
I don't think so. Did I yell at you at ROM? I yelled at a lot of people at ROM, but I yelled pretty bad at this guy. So anyway, I know what it's like.
It was me.
Yeah, I didn't help you at all. So that's a story. Basically, I was one of those kids who was not working hard enough at that tournament.
Yeah.
I just strolled in.
Well, that's all right. I mean, like, I knew who was in my available to help pool, and I just looked around and found the first person and grabbed him, and we got it done. And you just happened, perhaps conveniently, perhaps, you know, just incidentally, not to be there. But, you know, we all got it done, and I knew that I could have asked you.
Yeah.
If I needed to.
Well, to speak further to the point that I wasn't, you know, invested as much as you were. I remember when I was driving up, it was like maybe 10 o'clock. I saw you in like your sweatpants and your jacket, just booking it into the venue. You were like running down that street. Meanwhile, yeah. I was like casually driving to a parking spot. You know, pulled in, parked. You know, looked around, made sure that my shirt was on right, and then strolled in.
Yeah, but I mean, all the head NCR people were really great. They were all really accommodating, and they all like got back to me with my questions on everything, you know. And they let us do our own thing, and I think the room was pretty much the right size for us. And you know, we had enough setups. They gave us our own stream. We had a nice little kind of back patio for our room. That was pretty chill, and you know, we only got that one day, but you know, we got the stream for the top eight. We got about I think the number was about 5,600 people on the stream watching finals, so that was pretty awesome. The only kind of downside that I felt about it was that we were pretty much in our own room, and there wasn't a lot of cross exposure, you know, from the other games to us and vice versa. And I would have liked, you know, maybe a projector or, you know, something that would have been more easily accommodating for a larger audience for the FGC for our finals. Because
for sure,
we kind of just played on the TV, you know, on the side of the room. And, you know, I was happy to see a whole bunch of Smash people show up for that. I mean, we had at least like, I don't know, I want to say like 50 or 60 Smash people showed up and watched it, and that was great.
Yeah.
You know, especially since, you know, there was nothing going on for Smash that day except top eight.
Yeah.
We didn't have that room. There was no friendlies. You know, we couldn't do anything, but people showed up and you know, made the effort to come out and support the game and watch it, and that was, you know, that was really great to see. But I still would have liked a little bit more, you know, contact, miscegenation, if you will, with the other FGC.
Yeah, I would definitely want to echo that point. First of all, that I'm like major props to everybody who showed up to watch top eight. Like when I was home, I remember I was talking to Sophie about it, and I was like, "Well, I mean, I guess I don't even have to go to day two. You know, there's probably not even going to be many people there. 90% of the people are eliminated. There's only 9 people who really have to show up. That's Sheridan and the top eight. But yeah, there were a ton
two commentators.
There were a ton of people there. Well. Yeah, I mean, I didn't know if anybody was going to ask me, dude. I was really happy that they did. I think
gasping notwithstanding, you and Toph did a fantastic job. I went back and listened to everything, and it was great.
Dude, so Toph's probably here. I don't want to put him on blast. We already talked about it a little bit, but I remember, like, at the start, you know, we sat down, we started talking a little bit, and I remember I had, like, a lot of, you know how sometimes you're saying things just to kill time, but a lot of the time, Or rather, sometimes when you're saying something and you're like, this is a really good point. I really want to articulate this well. I was in those moments maybe two or three times, and then Toph would just cut me off and be like, there were moments where I'm glad the camera wasn't on me because I was literally, like, my face was just like,
yeah,
waiting for him to stop.
You were mugging.
I was so angry, but we hit our stride later on. You know, he stopped cutting me off for sure, mm-hmm. and I even cut him off a few times, and he was cool with it. So yeah, I had a great time.
Yeah, I definitely noticed that because I think in the beginning, you guys were too eager to talk about every single thing that happened, and you know you don't really need to do that. You know, yeah. Like I saw somebody post this. I don't remember who it was, but you know they said you noticed that. When you watch the professional commentators, you know, for sports or whatever, they find the times in the game to, you know, talk about something bigger than just what's going on in the present moment, you know? And that's definitely something you need in Smash. And it's harder to do that because everything's happening so fast. So, I mean, but, you know, they managed to do it in basketball and hockey, which are really fast games. So, but I think you guys did a really great job of picking your opportunities to talk about little aspects of the game, you know, just to understand, like, the couple of mechanics and why somebody does, you know, why somebody might do something that doesn't seem intuitive or, you know, how this particular mechanic works. I think you guys did a great job of finding ways to insert that info, make it clear to other people watching the stream that are not as familiar with Smash.
Yeah. Well, thanks, bud. I appreciate that. I hope other people also enjoyed our commentary. Shout out to Tove. He's amazing. We had a good time. But tons of people showed up to top 8, and the sets were really great. That's something else that, you know, commentators really need is to have, like, not boring, stupid sets. So yeah, good shit to our top 8 players who all played super well. Sung, shout out to Sung, made it to top 8. Good stuff, dude. So the results were HBox, Mango, Pew Pew. Was it West Balls after that?
Yeah.
Mango Trunch, West Balls. Who else? Who was before West? Fly. Fly tied with Johnny. And then Zoo and Sung at 7th. So those were top 8, and they all got seeding points for Evo? Or was it only top 3?
I, you know, to tell you the truth, I'm still not quite clear on the details, but
I thought that it was top 16.
It should be top 8, from what I understand.
Do I have to use my seeding points?
Do you have
can
to
I
use
I enter
them?
Something else so I can play Hungry Box first round and wreck them and then lose, and then wreck them and losers? I'm going to lose to the next person and just find them.
Just
I'm going to hunt them.
On the hunt.
I'm gonna hunt that dumb kid, dude.
Did you ever hear the story about Trevin and Hugo?
No.
Okay.
Who is it, Trevin? Who's Trevin?
Trevin? Oh, dude, Mega, you know Trevin, right?
Yeah, of course.
Yeah. So, this was like maybe 2006 or 2007, but Trevin always said he could beat Hugo, and that, you know, Link beat Samus, so... Trevin showed up to this tournament that Hugo went to. They met in, like, winners somewhere, like, maybe quarters or whatever. So they met in quarters, and Trevin wins. And then Trevin intentionally loses the match so that he'll get Hugo in losers, beats him in losers, and then leaves the tournament.
Oh, my God.
That's a SoCal. That's a super SoCal.
That is such a SoCal. Oh, my God. Dude, did he, was Hugs good at that point?
Yeah, dude, yeah. He was, like, still... I mean, he was top 5 at that point.
That's so funny. Oh, my God. Trevin. I wish I could meet this guy. He sounds like a hero.
Yeah, Trevin's a homie.
Mango, you want to talk about your experiences at NTR?
Real quick, before Mango gets in, Scar James Chen just replied.
What did he say?
So he said he if he can do it, it won't be until around 7:30... Pacific times, which would be around the very end. So, Scar, keep an eye on your Twitter.
Yeah, can you keep an eye on my Twitter?
I can't watch your Twitter. I don't know your password.
All right, I'm going to say awesome or something.
I got you. So, possibly James Chen, special guest tonight.
Yeah, that would be great. That would be awesome. We welcome him. Go ahead, Mango.
I think overall NCR was pretty just like pretty meh. And then I actually really like the bracket pool, whatever they do. I think it's really cool. Like, well, I feel bad for like all like the players, like, you know, like you, like Silent Wolf, you know, the players like at that level, and then like none of them make it out. But like it was so easy for me. I like showed up. I showed up, I junked Jeff, I junked Zach, and I was done with my day. I was like, oh, nice. This, I wish my life was always like this. And then I was done. And then bracket came. And actually, when I wasn't really in the mood to play. I thought it was pretty lame that we got the corner of the room.
Yeah.
And it, like, actually bugged me a lot. I thought that was pretty lame. So, like, when I played Kevin Toy, I, like, wasn't in the mood at all. And then I was like, this is, like, I don't want to, I feel like I was degrading myself just playing on this dumb little corner TV. So I already, like, didn't want to play Melee. And then I did. And then,
dude,
yeah.
You actually, you were trunching him pretty good, especially game three. And then you had that one Wheel of Fortune going on. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, the knee didn't connect, and he got a big downer on you at hella low percent. So that, I felt like, changed the set for you. But you were up on him 3 stocks to 1.
Once I was up, like, 4 stocks to 2, and then I thought, like, I'm just going to start doing whatever because I'm okay with losing. Since there's no other TVs, I won't be able to warm up. So if I go through losers, that'd be a nice warm up.
Yeah.
But then it ended up backfiring because I ended up playing too much Fox and started sucking. And then yeah, I junked everyone. I junked Hungrybox, but then I actually rewatched the set and it's like I'm so upset. It's not even at him, it's just like I'm super upset with myself. Like,
yeah.
I don't know why, like I don't know, I get so mad at myself. It like has nothing to do with him. Like, it's great that he punishes me, you know, like he's supposed to, like,
yeah.
You know, like good for him, you know, like nothing towards him, but like I don't like that, like, he got, like, super, I don't know. I'm just
the
mad.
Way that, the way he did the Hungrybox celebration.
And it's like,
dude, you know he's always going to do it. Whether
know,
he wins or loses, he's either going to celebrate that he won or be really depressed that he lost.
Yeah, but I feel like, I don't know, like, if Magic Johnson and Larry Bird played a one-on-one, and, like, and Larry Bird played bad, like, Magic Johnson wouldn't be too happy about the win. He'd be like, all right, I beat you, you know, but, you know. And he just gets, it's like, dude, like, I don't know, I was pretty upset.
He's a different
but, you know,
player. He's like, as a player, I don't think that he ever responds that way. You know what I mean?
Yeah, that's why he's not a true champion, dude. He just wants to win, and a true champion, you always want to beat someone at their best, dude. Always. Always,
quality
always.
Quality of the game.
Huh?
It's about quality of the game.
Agreed. It's like, winning's cool, but like, if you win and there's like nothing behind it, it's like, okay, good job.
Mods,
you get $300 more than me.
And if any of the mods can link to the set in the chat, I see a lot of people asking about it.
But you know, I still.
Winner on YouTube.
Yeah,
you know,
I play Winner on YouTube.
You may not be able to like play your best all the time, but you know, I think he should. You know, he might feel bad that you kind of deprived him of the opportunity to really test himself against that.
I doubt it.
That Uber Mango.
He just wants to win. Well Uber Mango came out in the first 3 matches, and he got absolutely whooped. I was playing so amazing in those 3 matches. Oh my god. And then it just like. And then like. I hate to like say this because it sounds like a John, but like. I always. Like, since the day I started playing this game, if I whoop someone super hard, I always. I always start like trying less. And it's like. Because I've been playing for so long, and if I junk people over, it's like, alright, I gotta keep myself interested. So like, I just stopped doing the run up shield, and then it just backfired hella hard. Because you can. For, like, 5 tournaments, you can't do anything about the run-up shield. I'm like, all right, well, this strategy is, like, foolproof. I'm just going to stop doing it and try to work on something else.
I want to ask a question that several people have asked me, too. Do you feel like your attitude has changed from, like, the old days, like Baby Mango?
Yeah, of course. Baby Mango was all heart, dude. That kid, man, he just wanted to win.
I think this is the big question. Do you want him to come back? Or do you, you know, feel like...
I think Baby Mango died with the Jigglypuff, dude. It's just, he's a whole different person. He plays Puff, and he does what he has to win. He'll gimp you 8 times in a match. Like, rescue, up throw, rescue all the time. No remorse, dude. And now, I don't know, I just got, like, older, and then, I don't know, I needed a way to have fun with the game. Like, if I didn't have fun, I don't know, I would have quit a long time ago. So I always need to keep myself interested. And you guys know Yu-Gi-Oh? I always compare Baby Mango as the Yu-Gi-Oh that comes out with the... With little, what's it called? The little thing he wears around his neck. That's Baby Mango, and then he just comes out and he's all business and just wants to win. He's all heart.
Has anybody watched Yu-Gi-Oh! Besides Mango?
That's Baby Mango.
I know exactly what he's talking about. I just don't want to admit it.
It sounds like a good comparison, but I don't know. I've never seen it. Like a noob.
So yeah, that's Baby Mango. He's got heart.
Yeah. Well, you know, from my two cents anyway, regardless, I thought the sets were pretty amazing. I really enjoyed you versus Kevin.
And then
the second set was amazing. I thought that Johnny played really, really well.
Johnny actually did play.
I felt so bad versus Westfalls because last stock, third game, it was obvious that both of them were super nervous.
Uh-huh.
And West just clutched it.
Dude, Johnny dropped a combo that he hits all the time. He had the grab on the platform, and
yeah,
I'm like, done.
You just go down and up air, right?
He could have up aired, he could have kneed, he could have reverse fallen off, reverse back air. He could have done so much, and then he did nothing. I'm like, you lost, dude. Like, you can't stop that as Falcon.
Yeah, that was the moment when I felt that he lost, too, because if you can't convert those kind of easy combos.
Yeah, he blew it really hard.
Yeah, but I felt that he definitely, he was playing better, but he got out-clutched.
Yeah, but I think overall, like, the top eight idea is really cool, because that makes every match, like, super interesting, and it's only, like, one going on at a time, so that was definitely pretty cool.
Yeah, well, that's also my feedback, so, for me, I agree with everything that Sheridan said. You know, it was awesome to be in that kind of venue. I thought the hotel was really sweet. The room that we had on its own was, like, pretty good. The outside, we had, like, an outside area that was, like, a pool lounge, which was pretty amazing. But, yeah, overall, I would have preferred to have been more embedded in the tournament. I think that this is, like, an ongoing theme. When there's Smash at, like, any tournament with multiple games, we always feel like, hey, why are we, like, in our own room not seeing anybody? It would have been super sweet to have been more embedded and also to have top 8 projected. That would have been pretty amazing. But I thought the event was really fun. And I don't know how much I love the bracket pool format because people like... Okay, so the people who got eliminated, some of the best people who were there, is Silent Wolf, who, like, you know, is obviously amazing. He didn't make it out. Axe didn't make it into top 8.
You know what the biggest heartbreak is?
Dewan and who? What's the biggest heartbreak?
That Richard Tan Shuttleworth did not make it out. That
Richard Tan Shuttleworth didn't make it to top 8? Oh.
Came, spent $50 that he doesn't have. gets DQ'd by Dickhead Allen, and then gets spanked and doesn't make it out.
Allen. He did get DQ'd.
Everyone for TO's watching, if Dunk's at your tournament, he has a really bad hearing problem. So if he doesn't hear you call him, like, you have to go find him and, like, alert him, or else he won't hear you.
Or at least ask one of his bros to find him, because there's several people who are willing to sacrifice everything to find Dunk.
Yeah.
It was really funny. It was like, I had to tell Allen that. It was like in Losers. No, it wasn't. It was in Teams. He was just like, Dunskies! Dunskies! And couldn't find him. And I was like,
right there.
I was like, well, he must not be there. And then I thought for a second, and I was like, oh, shit. You know, Dunk's, like, pretty much deaf.
Yeah.
So we had to, like, look for him. And there he was, you know, just playing his little friendly. But, yeah, the one thing that I did think was amazing is, you know, playing out to top 8 and then streaming each match. Because top 8 is usually the best matches. And I don't know. I thought it was really fun to have them all on one TV. Like, forget...
Yeah.
I can almost justify forgetting about streaming everything else and only streaming top 8.
Yeah. Top 8 was definitely... We should do that more often. It was definitely cool.
Yeah. Yeah, I totally dug it. So anyway, that was NCR. And then, yeah, as far as commentary goes, it was... I enjoyed commentating the sets. Again, sorry, guys. Dude, sorry I was... I don't know what happened.
God.
Dude, I think the problem was Mango commentating on me versus Ken, drunk Mango, would every once in a while be like, and I thought that it was like the funniest thing ever. And so I guess I just like assimilated
you stole it, dude.
But I went far with it. And then Oscar actually texted me. I could probably find the exact text. It was like, bro, you got to stop gasping. And I was like, LOL, you know, I couldn't help myself. And then I just stopped. I stopped because I knew I had to for the team.
For the fans.
He said, dude, stop gasping, LMAO. And then he said, like, 20 minutes later, K, start gasping again. Everybody misses it.
No.
So what? I don't know. I don't know what the truth is. I only got one side of the story.
You can have, like, one or two per set.
Yeah, I do one or two. And then that was pretty good. So anyway, that's that. Any comments, Prague or Cactuar, about NorCal Regionals? I don't know if you guys got to watch the videos or...
I'm watching them right now.
I watched the stream, man.
There's a lot of good matches.
First and foremost on the stream, big shout out to iPlayWinner for featuring Top 8. You know, iPlayWinner is one of the major streams in the FGC on the West Coast. So thank you for giving us an opportunity. Kaneda, again, with letting NCR be, you know, a Smash event. So the stream was largely fine. Everything worked out pretty well. And I was really trying to, like, see how a lot of the traditional people were taking Smash. But, you know, I think they went from Marvel to MK to Melee, which kind of lost some of the buzz. So it was a lot of our own. But it seemed like people took it well. They were invested. They were interested. And they want to know more, so.
Could you tell from the stream chat how many people were Smashers versus non-Smashers?
Like a majority. I'd say, like, maybe 80-20, 75-25.
Dude, but then that means that there were 4K Smashers watching. I struggle to believe that.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
I mean, what did we have at KOC2 was, like, 2,500? 2,000?
Yeah, that feels like our audience. And I feel like it must have been at least... Well, actually, could we do a quick test?
It might have just been... It might have been just that the Smashers are more active in stream chat than the others, so...
Yeah, I bet that's also true.
Alright, I want to see a quick 1 or 2. Press 1, type 1 if you watched, and 2 if you didn't.
What are we going to do with this? West? What is this?
I just want to look.
Alright.
Mango didn't watch. Okay, so the majority of people, at least in here, were watching, but some of them weren't. Okay.
The majority of people who responded.
Well, yeah, okay. Thanks, Sheridan.
Yes.
The majority of people who were watching this stream and responded did watch, but okay, that's only 100 people anyway.
We also have a self-selection bias.
God damn it. And we don't know how many times people press 1 because they could have done this. Dude, Mango, did you hear that I snuck in the...
Did you?
Yeah, okay, so we were talking about Fox,
dude,
actually.
I forgot about that.
I thought it was so funny, because you were chasing, I think, Hungrybox, and I was just like, you know, look at Fox work. You know, he's working so hard, and you're running so far, so fast.
Uh-huh.
And I just, like, made a panting sound, I was like... And then, I don't know, I just started talking about it, and I was like...
I know, I love that. That's, me and Joey have been doing that noise since we were, like, 12. That's a long... There's history behind that noise, man.
Dude, there's actually, like, a Mango influence on me. Like, I can totally tell because... Okay, I tweeted that I said that I called myself the kid at work. I was, like, I was actually texting my boss, and I asked her if she could make some time for the kid. And I was actually really proud of it. And now sometimes, like, when I'm talking about something and, like, I'm working hard and, like, I have a lot going on, I'll just be like, blah, 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 I gotta do this, that, and the other.
That noise is so amazing.
Dude, it's so funny.
You gotta hear Joey do it when he does, like, a sick Falcon combo. Like, he flies across the stage with a moonwalk, and that's, like, the best.
I'm never gonna hear it.
Wait, I gotta show everyone on the stream something. I gotta show everyone the Super Mango combo.
Alright, dude. Is it you?
Look at that.
Fly?
That video. 127. Everyone go watch the Super Mango combo.
You can watch it on stream.
While you're doing that, James Chen said he can't promise anything. He works until 7:15 his time, and it depends on traffic, but I told him if we're still active... when he's available, then we'll go and bring him on, so.
Oh, dude, this combo is actually outrageous. I watched it 4 times at work. Dynamic duo, but,
Oh, yeah.
It's crazy. I've been trying to do that to, like, every floaty. I go Falcon, so I can try and do that combo, and I finally got it on
Mango
horrible fly.
That knee move all over.
Is that the one on Yoshi's?
The other thing, too,
yeah.
Dude, the Nair. I've never seen anyone do that. I was so happy.
Dude, I only see people
nice
do that in, like, home run contests.
And then get that big forward smash.
Exactly. Oscar, why are you hating on my
here
combo?
Here it is.
Remember, Popo can DI moves to survive and to get out of combos.
Oh my god, that was he snuck a Twinkle Toes in the middle of the combo.
That was
Twinkle Toes,
so sick.
Twinkle
Toes. so much creativity in that combo.
I was so happy to talk about Twinkle Toes. Whenever I can sneak Twinkle Toes in, dude.
Yeah, you die. The commentators, you talked about it for like 4 seconds.
I distinctly recall you mentioning it twice.
The Twinkle Toes! He sneaks the Twinkle Toes in there! Yeah, that's pretty sick. Nice work, Mango.
Thanks. Yeah. Even if I lose, no one can ever say I don't have the greatest combos, dude. I always take that with me.
Yeah, that was a good one.
Wow, love
it.
Oscar, why are you hating, dude?
Dude, Oscar gave it a 5.5 out of 10. Holy
crap. Are you
kidding
me? 5 out of... You know what a 5 is? That's like a sheet combo is like a 5.
Like forward tilt to F air.
That's a 5.
Yeah.
I don't know. I feel like forward tilt to like down air to forward air. is a 5 for Sheik. It's like a whatever, you know, whatever. Screw you. Yeah, I would definitely give it at least an 8 out of 10. I would probably a 9 out of 10 most days. 10 out of 10 is like one of those combos I won't give people.
No, 10 out of 10 is like once a year, like I'm crazy.
Yeah.
10 out of 10 is hard to achieve.
How could you say around? Yeah, it was amazing. But I definitely did shout myself out a few times. I couldn't have played, but I still had to say, you know, oh, that's a scar combo. you did like an up air to falling down air. I was like, you know, I'm pretty sure that's a scar combo. You know, I have to say. And Tobe was like, yeah, it's yours. And I was like, okay, that was too easy. All right. So yeah, amazing. That was at CR, guys. I'm actually gonna link to the video that I just closed. That makes it a little bit more difficult. Oh, Mango already linked it. Okay. And just check out I Play Winner on YouTube. You know, feel free to subscribe. And all of the videos are on their stream, or their YouTube channel. And they're pretty sick, so I recommend checking them out. And comment on the YouTube video and be like, hey, Melee's amazing. Speaking of YouTube videos, ready to move on?
Yes.
Speaking of YouTube videos, so as you know, NCR was a tournament with the a lot of representation from the greater fighting game community, and James Chen, I think Ultra David was there as well. I know Skeet Sonic was there, who was a special guest on our show, and I would have loved to talk to him, but and so, you know, we kind of restarted the conversation with him a little bit. As many of you know, I was trying to, you know, get on like maybe an episode or something, get some of us on to talk about Melee with Ultra Chen or like Maximilian or anywhere really. And it kind of petered out, and we didn't really talk about it much, but after NCR, you know, we restarted the conversation. So, basically, we have an opportunity to show, like, maybe 3 games on, I guess on stream, right? And just kind of talk about Melee.
On their cast, UltraChenTV, which is one of the premier casts in the FGC.
Yeah, and just kind of, like, talk about Melee, talk about what we think is awesome about it, which I think is one of the coolest things to talk about. So, basically, now we're at a position where we want to, like, what 3 games are we going to show? My question is, like, what story do we want to tell? A lot of people have, you know, given their 2 cents on Twitter. Thank you guys so much for tweeting at me with a bunch of, what's wrong with the poll? Well, anyway, thanks for tweeting at me with your ideas. So a lot of the things were, like, what were they? Old to new, we talked about. Like, you know, hey, maybe we could check out, like, old KDJ versus MGK and see how that matchup has evolved. Something that I like thinking about is if we get a large variety of characters and we could talk about, like, what their strengths and weaknesses are so that we could start at least talking a little bit about weight and how that affects combos. Sheridan Super wants to talk about the current metagame, which I think is a great idea. And something else that I wanted to jot down was, like, if there's any explicit parallels between, you know, 2D fighters and Smash, maybe we could find games to exemplify that. So anyway, I just linked to this poll with like a few sweet matches, and we want to see what your ideas are. So should we watch some of them and just talk about them ourselves? I feel like that could be really fun.
I think that might take up a little bit too much time.
No.
I mean, maybe a couple, but
like one.
I think we should discuss like what it is, you know, that we want to show to other people. Yeah.
All right.
So what do you think that is, Sheridan?
While we talk, I'll have some of them on the stream. So.
Okay, yeah, sure, totally. Well, I think, like Scar mentioned, I think all the matches should be of the current metagame. I think the old versus new is kind of too broad of a topic and requires too many videos to really, you know, get the full picture of. You know, we can't do that in 3 videos. So I think, you know, the first thing is these matches should highlight the current metagame. They should be interesting matchups, you know, and I think they should show, like, the diversity of, you know, strategies in the game. So, just, like, kind of off the top of my head, I thought we should have, like, you know, like we should have 2 matchups involving the same character, but against different characters. So, like, you know, maybe Marth versus an ice climber, or not ice climber, Marth versus a spacey and Marth versus a floaty, or like Fox versus Falco and Fox versus a floaty, so that you see like how different, you know, you have to change your game to change, you know, to fight different characters. And, you know, I think we should get like a ice climbers or some kind of, you know, lesser represented character in there just to show like how different. I think ice climbers especially is good because they play really differently compared to most other characters. So it shows you just kind of like, you know, again, how diverse the skill required in this game is. So that was kind of the basic ideas that I thought of.
So can you give those to me again? I wrote down different styles for the same character but different matchups.
Yeah.
And then also like less represented characters.
Yeah, I maybe not less represented, but more unique.
So like,
you know, you could even consider Peach. You know, Peach I think plays somewhat differently than most other characters.
Okay.
And you know, Peach is Armada, so.
And chat, feel free to chime in about this. I'm definitely watching the chat. We're interested to hear everybody's ideas about this. Okay. The poll link. Can somebody link to the poll? I don't want to pull it up because my computer's chugging along. Well, what about the... I felt like we should at least have one set that's like a West Balls dominating somebody when he was unbelievably technical, because that's just so much fun to watch, and like the idea of, you know, how technical
be. I don't think we should have a match that's just one guy obliterating another guy. I think it should be, if we can, a match where like each stock it goes back and forth, like one guy obliterates this guy one stock, and then this guy comes in and just like, you know, totally zero to death him, and it just goes back and forth like that for the whole game. Like, that's optimally what I think we should see from all of these.
There's probably some sets like that, though, right?
Do you have an example in mind?
Certainly.
Yeah.
Somebody wrote down GPU Silent Wolf.
Yeah, somebody mentioned that. I can't think of one off the top of my head.
Mango,
I mean,
can you think of a video
that
you watched that was like, oh my god, this face is playing perfectly. Or like amazing,
I mean,
or super fast.
A lot of the matches from the NCR really. Top 8 were really good.
I think, yeah, a lot of the NCR matches were definitely pretty good. It's hard for, I don't know, there's only a few matches where, like, a spacey plays perfect the whole match. It's a rare occurrence.
Yeah. I was going to say you versus Taj, but I actually went back and watched it, and he was kind of playing like a buster.
I played pretty bad, too. It's just he played so terrible that it made me look good regardless.
Yeah, exactly.
I missed so much stuff.
I saw you missed, and I don't remember it that way. Like, when I watched it for the first time, it felt like you played perfectly.
No, I definitely did. I played, like, 7 out of 10. I'm just so much better than him that it didn't matter.
Didn't he beat you?
Somebody mentioned...
Get me, yeah.
Yeah.
Somebody mentioned, I think, Kirby Kaze versus... I don't know. It was either Johnny or Hax, but... Apparently, I haven't seen this, but somebody mentioned this as an example of one where, like, you know, you get the grab in or you get the stomp in, and that's basically your stock.
What about, like, Hax versus Kage? Not that we want to give Kage any credit.
No.
Didn't Kage win?
Kage's not getting it.
Kage's won some...
He's won a few.
Yeah. How about the Johnny versus Kage one where Kage gets trunched?
I'm down for Kage getting trunched anyway.
Dude, that video is so funny. That smash, that DI is so bad. Lol. So right now I'm watching Javi versus Leffen.
Yeah.
That was an okay set.
I remember watching that. I don't remember having like strong thoughts on it.
Nah, it's just... I mean, that's like the first Fox Ditto to happen in like 3 years.
Yes.
Besides Lucky J-Man, that's it. I think Lucky J-Man's a pretty good set.
Yeah, that was a really solid set.
Yeah, it's pretty, for Fox Dittos, they both play pretty good and bad, and then they just junk each other back and forth.
Is there, like, one game where they both play really well? That would be amazing.
I can ask Joey. Joey only watches his matches, so he'll give me a good... he'll give me a legit answer.
Dude, is he, like, West Coast Scar?
What do you mean?
Can we make a case for, like, you know, back when I was East Coast, that he was the parallel? Like, I only used to watch my matches, you know. I feel like we have a lot... Me and Joey secretly have a lot in common.
Joey watches his matches and my matches, and that's it. and I don't think he has, like, any favorite players. He's his own favorite player.
I only watched my matches and Hex's matches for a long time.
You are like Joey. Yeah. I wish you guys knew Joey. Joey thinks he's the second best player in the world. and I think so, too. Only I've
when
seen
he's
him
playing
play,
well.
Like, so perfect. That guy is, I have to always shout it out, dude. He's so good. But, like, I don't know. We both have the same shitty mentality sometimes that gets to us. If we're playing bad, we're just like, we're playing bad. That's it. There's no hope for me to play better.
I feel like it's so funny when he loses to, like, really bad people in tournament.
Oh, my God. I just walk up to him, and I'm like, did you lose? And he just nods his head. He said, yeah. He's just like, like, you know what happened. I'm like, yeah. I know, dude. Okay.
You just shake your head. That's what I always do. It's just like, you can't do anything. You just shake your head.
Whenever I hear of, like, a Spacey player losing to someone that they're way better, I'm just like, I know exactly 100% how that set went.
Yeah.
You approached, messed something up, and died. 8 times. And it's like, yep, that's what happened.
Poor Spaceys. Life of Spaceys.
It's such a...
Spaceys.
It's like a life of, like, a rock star. You know, they have all kinds of fun, but then they do too much drugs and, like, waste their money. Like, being a Spacey, you live the best life you can possibly live in Melee, and you also live the absolute worst life you can live in Melee. Like, Spaceys are literally, like, the rock star who, like, overdoses and, like, they just ruin themselves, dude. It's, like, ridiculous.
I actually really want to talk about that. If we do get to talk to UltraChen,
mm-hmm.
Like just about like the supreme number of options that they have, and how if you play perfectly with Spaceys, they're so amazing. But
like to play amazing with them, it's like you got to be on point with
everything. Sometimes a party ends and it's really ugly.
You drank too much. You're throwing up at the end of the night, dude.
Yeah.
You just party too hard.
Yeah, yeah. If you party too hard, if you don't know your limit as a Spacey player, you're gonna have a bad day.
Yeah. Yeah. I actually want to write a long post about all the characters. I have a lot to say about each one, about all the top tiers. I think floaties are like I call them, they're like half god and half human. I don't know what the word would be for that.
Demigod.
Yeah, whatever. Sheridan will give you guys the right word. But I feel like they're like half god because like the stuff that they don't have to deal with sometimes, like it's so like the fact that they don't have to worry about teching or like crazy fast tech skill or like recovery or like any of this stuff that like it's like you have all of that and it's like so good, right? But then they also have stuff that makes them like just a human like anyone else. They're so bad sometimes, but like the stuff that they're like god with, it's like so broken, dude. Like, and I don't know, they can trade with everything and like I don't know, I think they're pretty amazing sometimes. They're gods, but then they're humans. It's like it's weird.
Dude, go back to 2009. That's what I was talking about.
Yeah,
I was saying like, yeah, I hated that Puff could just recover from anything. Like, she doesn't have to worry about it. I hated that, you know, I don't know. I still kind of hate Last Stock with Puff because it's just so scary.
No, oh, that's also the worst part. When you're playing against a floaty and you're both like at 80%, I always say that the floaty's in the lead. I always say that.
Yeah,
because you have
Stock's
to hit them
really
about
terrible.
4 times and they only have to hit you once. I think that's so dumb. Like that, in those cases, I think floaties are like amazing.
Oh, wow.
Like, and then especially at a big tournament, like you have to outplay this guy 4 times and he only needs to nick you once. It's like, oh.
Yeah.
They're just so—they're so broken sometimes, dude.
But they need
so crappy
to be like perfect decisions, because if they don't play well with that power, you know, you like die so easily.
Yeah, but I think at the top level, most floaty players are always gonna make pretty safe floaty decisions. Yeah, floaties just always do everything so safe with them. Like they never. Oh, I don't want to go into it, dude. We'll be here for like 3 hours. That's why I stopped playing Puff, dude, because it was so easy. You get so much. You don't have to worry about anything. Your life's like so easy. It's just like. You're playing against the Fox, right? I can't get grabbed at 50%. That's it. And then if I don't get grabbed and I live to 90, I'm gonna live to like 140. It's like it's so easy.
I actually really like talking about that. I feel like it's super fun.
Like the characters?
Yeah.
You can talk. Melee, like it's so fun to talk about. It's like one of my favorite things to talk about, Smash Bros.
Yeah.
Man. It's so good. I can never get over how good of a game it is.
I also think that like it's super interesting that, you know, even. I feel like forever, there's only been, like, a maximum of 3 really good Puffs ever, right? Like, at one point, there was probably you, HBox, and somebody.
And King.
Yeah, right.
How can you not say that?
I was
going to
say King, but
I'm so
mad. No. Let me talk it out. No. It's because I didn't know if you guys were playing at the same time. That's the only reason.
You played first, then I played a little after, and then HungryBox came.
Did you guys all play at the same time? At any point?
There was probably a little period where we were all playing, but HungryBox sucked.
Okay. Yeah, so I guess that's basically what I'm saying. I'm not sure. But yeah, it's interesting that she looks so good and has, like, you know, I don't know, she can look amazing, but she can also look terrible.
No, yeah, that's how floaties are. There's, like, some situations where, like, man, this character's so good, but then, like, 10 seconds later, it's like, never mind, this character's awful. That's like how I would define floaties to like someone who doesn't know the game. It's like, yeah, they might look bad, but no, they have a lot of stuff that's like secretly like amazing.
And what makes the low tiers like low tiers?
They don't exist.
They not have the options. Melee,
they don't exist in my head. They're just mid tier and below don't exist to me because they just suck, dude.
Yeah, I do.
But they're just bad. I think they can make it happen, but like to play good with like Ganon or something, like, you have to play
Roy,
perfect.
Dude.
No, Roy's the worst character. Roy's so bad. I wouldn't say he's the worst. I think Kirby's the worst.
No, I know, but I mean, he's just like, I don't know. Roy's just so fucking bad, dude. He can't do anything. His sword is basically a fly swatter.
Still probably counters Falcon, though.
Dude, sometimes when you
I think everyone does okay versus Falcon.
Yeah, I mean, everybody can. It's just a question of whether you're able to.
Man, Falcon's he's got a hard life.
He does have a hard life.
And actually, when I was in Sweden with Scar, and I realized, I'm like, wait, you have to play Falcon all day. Like, I'm like, I only play Falcon in matchups I really like. Then I'm like, wait a minute, you have to play Falcon against all these sheep and, like, all these Falcos and Foxes all day? I'm like,
all
I would
day.
Go crazy. I would go so crazy if I had to play Falcon all day. Like, I would go so, I don't know how you do it, dude. I always give shout-out to Falcon players.
Dude, that's why, I feel like at the top levels, you know, Falcon players can do really well, but then, you know, you'll just run into that Spacey who's having a good day, and it just looks like you suck.
Hard.
You know what I mean? Like, Hacks at Apex, what was it? Not 2013, 2012. The way that he lost to Javi just looked so terrible. It looked like Hacks didn't know what he was doing.
Oh, yeah. Like, Javi just played, like, super basic Fox.
Exactly. And, like, the way that he lost to you, like, okay, game one was okay, but, you know, game two, he just got trunched. And, like, that'll happen sometimes.
Yeah, no. I don't know how you do it. I think Falcon players are the manliest. In the tier list of who's got the biggest nuts, it's Falcon. It's Falcon, then Spacey's. And then, and then Marf, and then Sheik.
Well,
and
what
then...
about low tiers, though? Low tiers, you gotta give...
No, low tiers, you have no brain is what you have.
Okay.
You got no brain. You can have the biggest nuts, but you got no brain.
Shout out to GP, who is in chat, who's he's got the biggest balls out of anybody I've ever seen play.
Yeah, GP's the homie.
I've never seen anybody... Okay, since West Balls in, like, 2010, I've never seen anybody give less of a shit about their stocks. It feels like GP cares 0% whether he's alive or dead.
Yeah, that's pretty... Oh, poor Zach. Oh,
dude, look
Zach.
At that. So tragic. That was a really tough handshake for him to do. Oh, what was I doing?
You were just smiling. You were right.
Yeah, that's what I do when my best friends lose. I just sit there
you just smile.
I don't know what to say.
Dude, no way.
I never know either, like, because I don't like people coming up and talking to me, like, if I lose some stupid match.
I hate it.
Oh, my God, when I lose and someone's like, dude, you'll get him next time, it's like, no, shut up, don't talk to me.
Yeah, get out of here.
Leave me alone.
Dude, alright, Tope's leaving. I'm about to put him on blast again. The maddest I've ever been in a set in my entire life, Tope's probably still here. The maddest I've ever been in a set was after I lost to Tope at, where was it, Northwest Manifest 2? He actually made me quit the game. I think many people have heard the story. And after he beat me, he like got up and like tried to hug me, and I wanted to be like, get the fuck out of my face.
Oh my God.
Oh my God. I was so mad at him.
I'm glad you bring that story up because it's so funny. You said you and Joey are similar. Joey, like, he was playing Zoo, and Zoo like went Fox and beat him in a Fox Ditto, and Joey was furious. And Zoo like gets up, hugs him, and Joey's like nodding his head and looking at me while he's getting hugged. I'm like, oh, dude, let him go, dude.
It was so bad.
Get off him.
But he was just trying to be a homie, right? And I knew that, but in the moment, I was like, you better get off of me right now.
Yeah. Oh, you know what I hate? When I get like 4-for-3 at a tournament and people are like, good job, I get so mad. It's like, no, good job. I didn't win. What are you talking about? Get away from me. Don't tell me good job. There's nothing to say.
Amazing.
I get so mad. And all the noobs come up to me and, like, you know, they just want to, like, congratulate, like, you know, because they're happy.
Yeah.
4th place is a big deal, like, whatever. But to me, I get so mad. I'm like, nah, dude. If you're not first, you're last. I live my life on that. It's all about winning.
That doesn't even make any sense. You can get 2nd. Yeah, you can get 3rd. You can even get 4th.
1st place would get all the money in the...
Which NCR did, by the way, right? I mean, if
they got
anybody...
80. Yeah.
It's 70, 20, 10.
70, my bad, yeah.
Is that it? Okay,
yeah.
I think
because it looked way drastic compared to usual Melee, you know, pot splits. Like, HBox got 511, I think, and Mango,
yes.
You only got, like, 150.
I got, like, 146.
Which in my brain is not 70-20, but I guess you're right. Yeah, you're right.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I mean, they definitely, you know, give the winner way more than we usually do.
Yeah. NorCal usually does 50-30-20.
Oh, NorCal. That's such a NorCal thing to do. You have no idea. Like,
look,
we're such a
we
family.
We love everybody,
dude. Reward everyone. Pat on the backs, guys.
Yeah.
Hate NorCal.
Oh, fuck.
I can never live. You guys are so friendly with each other that if I stay there longer for 3 weeks, I start losing my mind, dude. Like, I gotta get out. I gotta go home where people are mean to me. I hate when I'm in NorCal and I do a good combo and someone's like, dude, nice combo. It's like, no, don't tell me. I know it's a nice combo. You don't need to tell me.
Everybody's just so enthusiastic.
It's ridiculous, dude. NorCal's a crazy place, man.
Yeah. Do you want to get Justin in real quick?
What's Justin going to say?
I don't know. He's just going to talk about NCR and his perspective from being on both sides.
Okay.
Yeah. All right. So we're going to pull Falconist in really quick.
The homie, Falconist.
Hey, how do I unban people on Twitch? Dude, Justin, you there?
Yeah, can you hear me?
Yeah, man.
Hi, Justin.
What's up?
Yo, what's up? What's up, everyone? So before you guys want to talk about NCR, I just want to say thank you to Sheridan and Tafikins, especially for helping running Melee at NCR.
Well, you're the guy that kind of got us into it. You know, you're the one that talked to Terry and then talked to me and gave us the opportunity,
yeah.
So I appreciate that very much, too. And, you know, answering every single little question I had when I was there. So, you're awesome.
Yeah, I just wanted...
NorCal loves each other, dude. We're a bunch of lovers.
Feet in my stomach.
So what's up? What's up, Justin?
I'm tired.
Yeah.
Just came back from work and stuff.
So what was your... what were you specifically at NCR for? Would you say that you were tied to, like, one game or another, or...?
I was doing a lot of things at NCR. I mean, first and foremost, you know, competition is always a fun thing. So I entered, like, 4 different events. Cross Tekken, Street Fighter, Marvel, and Melee, I guess.
Amazing.
Yeah, I was there to help run Smash. That's why I shared it and helped me out. And I was also there because I created, actually, all 16 bracket pools for Marvel. Because they needed help on that, too.
Amazing. And so what was your feeling about, you know, the tournament? How do you think it ran? You know, do you feel like, you know, tell me what I want to hear, Justin. You don't have to tell me what I want to hear, but you know what my questions are.
To be quite honest, I think Melee ran... Well, the turnout was not what we were hoping for. Because I think we were hoping, like, 80 to 100.
How many did we get?
73.
That's pretty close. But, yeah, I mean, 80 would have been better, but...
Yeah, so basically the deal was... I think NCR for Melee ran well. I don't know if you guys liked the room, but, I mean, it's hard to fit, like, 9 different games over the weekend for a tournament, so it's just like,
yeah.
You guys got a room to yourself, so...
I like a room.
Yeah, so I really try to push for Terry to say, hey, you know, Melee's the truth in NorCal and in SoCal, like, all in Cali, and I think it would be best to run, like, a Melee tournament for the Evo seedings. Mm. But what people don't know is that NCR is run by 2 people. It's run by Terry Kaneda, and the other one's run by John Choi, who's a legend in the fighting game community.
Right.
So, at first, John said no, because he was afraid about the turnout. But but Terry convinced him, so... And it ends up being, like, Melee had, like, the 4th overall most entrance.
Yeah, after the big 3.
Yeah. So, I think it ran really well. I don't know how you guys feel, that maybe the venue was too small for you guys or whatever, but, you know, it's just like, it's hard to run all those games at once.
Yeah. No, I feel like the feedback was, like, really good. You know, we enjoyed the tournament. The only thing was that we kind of felt like, yeah, I mean, the room was just kind of, we were by ourselves, and like Sheridan said earlier, you know, even if we just had, like, a projector for finals, it would have been amazing.
Mm-hmm.
But it was just kind of like, you know, we were in the corner.
Yeah. The thing is like, I thought there was going to be a projector for the secondary stream.
Yeah.
for the second room, but that ended up not being there.
So it was just basically like, you know, the primary stream on Spooky had the projector and like the big setup, but the iPlayWinner one didn't.
Yeah, pretty much.
Yeah, so, you know, whatever. It was still fun, you know, it was a great time. Again, we had like super sweet matches. And
yeah, I was so sad because I had to run my Marvel tournament matches.
Oh.
So it was just like...
Just like what?
Sorry. Basically, I had to miss all of Melee because I had to do my tournament matches, and I was really sad.
Yeah, that stinks.
Yeah, because, I mean, I watched every single video that was uploaded, so that was fun to watch. Just sad, like, I didn't get to see Kevin win.
Yeah.
Against Mango, even though I think Mango just let him win.
What was I going to say? What do you see for the future?
The future, let me think.
The future.
I don't know. It's like, my question is to the community, is like, do you guys really want to be included into the fighting game community?
Well, according to many people, we already are. So,
yeah, but if you realize, like, we've gone pretty far, like, even without the fighting game community, in my opinion.
Yeah.
It's just that there's a lot of factors that, I guess that hurt us, like, back when, like, MLG was big for Melee.
Yeah.
Or for, like, Brawl. And I feel like certain actions made it cause, like, the community to go down a bit in terms of, like, being competitive, like, in, like, an esport world or whatever, mm-hmm. whatever you want to call it. Mm-hmm. But, I mean, like, there's a potential for us to be out there again. It's just going to take time.
Well, yeah, that's kind of how I feel, right? And you know, we're making moves now in ways that we haven't in a long time. So, you know, we definitely fit in better with, you know, we are fighting. Our game is a fighting game, right? It's not an RTS. So, you know, we don't fit in with the RTS scene as well as, or the FPS scene. And the, you know, fighting game scene is kind of where our game fits in and where there's most potential for crossover.
Right. And, I mean, if we're going to have any opportunity to get bigger than what we are, it's going to be, I think, through, you know, being part of a larger fighting game community.
Because that's what it's all about, right? I mean, for me, a part of it is to grow the Smash scene, but at the same time, I'm invested in the gamer community more than anything, I think. You know, I feel like one of the things that binds all of us, even the RTS guys, even the you know, Counter-Strike guys and first-person shooter guys, is that we're all gamers, and we kind of have similar experiences, and so gamer culture is something that I'm super interested in. So to be part of, like, that movement in general, you know, esports is gaining a lot of steam, so we want to contribute. At least I want to contribute to that in a meaningful mm-hmm. way.
Yeah, I mean, I think if you... I would agree, like, the people who are just doing this because they just want to be respected by fighting game people, that's not the reason to do something like this. You know, your validation comes from, you know, what you've done as a community. And, you know, we don't need validation to be who we are. But at the same time, you know, I think it's better for everybody to just be part of a larger community.
What do you say to that, Justin?
Yeah, I totally agree. Like, the funny thing is that when I first joined the FGC a lot of the top players in fighting games actually really respect Melee as a game. Actually, like, when I have to, like, explain it to them, they're like, oh, yeah, we get it and stuff. And, you know, it's just like, well, you know, why can't Melee be part of, like, this community too, like, combined together and such to grow bigger? So,
how does that conversation generally go?
It would be like, well, they'll be like, when I first joined, they'll be like, oh, you're from the Melee community, right? I'm like, yeah. And they're like, oh, don't you just do all that, like, wave dashing bullshit, what have you? So then when you have to talk to, like, a normal player, it's just like you have to explain everything in detail. But then when you talk to, like, a top player, like, you don't have to really explain much. Like, they understand everything in the game. the way they see it. Like, if I explain to them, like, a technique and how it's related to a fighting, like, fighting game, like, terminology, they'll mm-hmm. understand it, like, completely. So, they have, like, they have, like, a lot of respect for the Melee community, in my opinion. It's just those, you know, trolls and what have you people that stay in the house and do nothing and don't compete. That's, yeah. Those are the people that don't understand.
Well, I mean, that's I see this in the Smash community, too, because it's, like, what you bring up has a parallel, because, like, you know, it's the people who are the tryhards that want to feel like they're part of the community and know what they're talking about in the fighting game community that try to shit on Melee to try to, you know, make themselves look cool.
I feel the exact same way, Sheridan. 100%.
And I think that there's too many people in the Melee community that just talk shit about Brawl all day so they can feel like they're cool people in the Melee community. And, you know, you're fine Brawl if you sucks. Don't like Brawl. I think Brawl sucks, but I don't spend time thinking about it. I don't care. If you like it, then freaking play it, and they should be proud of the community, you know, that they've been able to sustain that long for a game that, you know, I personally don't care for.
Right.
But, you know, just let them have fun.
Let them, please.
I totally agree with that, Sheridan.
Yeah, but the funny thing is, like, that applies to even, like, fighting games within themselves, which is pretty funny.
Yeah, I bet that's
sure it does.
Yeah, it's just like, oh, you like Injustice? Well, I don't like Injustice. It's a shit game, and then they just explain why, and yada, yada, yada. It's horrible.
Yeah.
All right. Justin, you have anything else to add?
Actually, I want your guys' opinion. What did you guys think of NCR? Like,
well, if you had watched the show...
You tuned in.
If you tuned in, you would have heard it already.
I was busy at work. Give me a break.
Everybody boo Falcomus on chat. No, I'll give you the clip notes is what I actually already said. It's just basically, you know, we had a great time. We really liked we had mixed feelings on the bracket system. But, I mean, you know, it's just a different tournament format. And some of us really liked it, some of us didn't. We really liked streaming top 8 sequentially on one TV. I thought that was awesome. And I think that everybody else did too. In general, we were able to produce like really high quality matches, which was awesome. And, you know, the only complaint that I have and that most people seem to echo is that we would have loved to have felt more embedded in the tournament. That's just part of a greater, a larger theme. And, you know, it's okay. We totally get it. You know, but I would have brought a projector if I had known.
Yeah, I at cents. Least wanted a projector.
I would have gone to the store and rented one. I mean,
was it 2006? We had no projectors.
Yeah, we had a few people back like near the commentary kind of stand just to watch the preview screen because I couldn't see the TV. So you know, that's that.
Yeah.
Okay. Actually, I actually enjoyed you and Chris's commentary. I thought that was really good.
Thanks, bud. We had a lot of fun.
Yeah, it was good.
All right, Justin. Anybody else?
Yeah.
Somebody about to say something? All right, Justin. Hey, man. Thanks so much for coming on.
It's a pleasure. Thank you. I'll just tune into the rest on Twitch. So.
Nice. Thanks, bro. And subscribe to my channel if you haven't already.
All right. I'll do that.
Nice. All right, dude.
All right, later.
See you, Justin.
Yeah.
And by the way, I wonder if any of Prog, Sheridan, Mango, or Cactus are not subscribed.
To what?
I actually am not subscribed to.
Dude, can you say...
What am I subscribed to?
To my stream.
I don't subscribe to anything.
Maybe I am.
You don't have any subscriptions. So
I got an email...
No, follow.
I got an email...
I'm sorry.
I got an email when this went live, so
yeah,
that
so
probably means
are.
I am.
Yeah, I'm following, but you're not a...
partner.
You are.
Yeah, that's okay.
Partners, you're not subscribed. I can't subscribe.
All right, so we spent a ton of time on the NCR topic, and we talked a lot about the video. I don't think that we came to any conclusion, but I think that might be okay for now. So, do you want to move on to the community topic? I feel like we should just take call-ins for this, but I want to introduce
Where were we going to get the documentary guy on here?
Yeah. I feel like we should lead it in, and then we'll pull him on.
Sure.
Love that everyone calls him documentary guy.
Yeah, we kind of do. His name is Travis, right?
Documentary guy.
Travis, yep.
Travis the documentary guy.
A.K.A. Samox. From East Point Pictures, based out of Boston.
Prog, you would know, dude.
There we go.
Not surprised.
So this is the post that I made on the Melee and On Me Facebook group. I just wanted to talk about community. I guess the sense that I got and the reason that I really want to talk about this is because I felt like when Evo was kind of – when the donation drive was going on, I felt this, like, energy, you know, this kind of sense of community awareness. And, like, all of us were kind of on the same page and, like, working towards a similar goal. And it just felt like I was in touch with, you know, what we cared about. Super hard, and I appreciated that a lot. I don't know if everybody appreciates that, but you know, it's kind of important to me, and now I feel like you know, we still have a lot of energy and a lot of momentum, but it definitely is not where it was, like, you know, 2 months ago. And I don't know if everybody feels the same way or everybody's interested in that or whatever. So I just wanted to talk about, you know, are there times where we feel more like, you know, a cohesive community than other times, and is it important to you to feel that way? Is it not important? And just kind of share our experiences with that. So yeah, for me, I mean, when the donation drive was going on, I was super stoked about everything forever. And like, Apex, while I was there and a little bit after, I don't know if it's because it was the same time frame, but you know, Apex was so hype and I was so excited. And then when I went to Sweden, I was pretty hyped too. So it's like big tournaments for me, and also like when we had a goal. I thought that was so dope.
Yeah. I mean, I don't even know what to say about the donation drive. I mean, I just feel so... I felt so accomplished afterwards.
Amazing.
And, you know, I think it just goes to show you that, you know, having a goal in front of you that, you know, you can really see and understand is, like, what really drives people. And it's, you know, maybe the most important thing to have in your life. And so when you have something like that, everybody, it was crazy to see, like, you know, we had to have our own sub forum on Smashboards for this, and as dead as Smashboards is right now, that place was just popping the whole time during the drive. So that was fantastic.
Damn, it just got off. Like, I hate it so much. I got unbanned. I was using it all the time. Then they changed it. Now it's like,
they have like 3 skins you can use now. I think maybe you're able to make your own one even, but that's probably too much effort.
You know, Smashboards just got brawled. That's all that happened. Smashboards got so brawled.
No. Poor Brawl. Dude, Brawl's having a tough day today. We're giving it the
business. I would rather have the old one too. Classic Blue, man.
Classic Blue is amazing. How about Mango, Prague, Cactus, any comments on that before we pull in
the question?
Documentary guy? Just like, you know, do you feel like, you know, when are the times when you felt like the community was, like, most powerful and most, like, united, and was that important to you? Like, do you feel like it's worth chasing after and trying to, like, you know, I don't know.
I miss late day MLG. I feel like we had a sense of purpose as far as everybody wanted to get better, to be on this stage.
Yeah.
And, like, PC Chris was up there, KDJ was up there, Ken was up there, Asim was up there. And, like, when you thought about those players, because they were up on that pedestal, like, they were revered. Now we're all, like, homies because community's gotten to that point. But, like, back then, those people were removed from the community. They had a different status.
What?
Yeah, I mean, now that you bring that up, I really can't think of a period in Smash history where, I mean, we had such an extended period of time where, you know, we had so much focus and there was so much attention in our game and, you know, everybody kept up with everything that was going on at these tournaments like nothing else. I mean, nowadays, you know, I mostly myself just keep up with what happened in tournaments, you know, basically in California. And I don't really pay attention to that much of what happens to the rest of the coast. But back in those days, when MLG was going on, everybody was interested in every single detail of what was happening at those tournaments. Because this was a huge step up. And I think that's really... We're really hoping for something like that to come out of this Evo thing.
I think, you know, not even talking about periods in Smash, but periods for every player. when the game is new to you, when you're getting into it, you're looking at all these videos for people you revere, people you admire, trying to understand what they're doing, how they're doing it, things like that. I think for every player, that's going to be like one of those highly touted moments. But in terms of community's history, of course, the donation drive will have no equal. You know, when we were all motivated to get this game, perhaps our last shot, at a main stage appearance. We had a couple of rivals that were definitely spooking us a bit with Skullgirls and Two Turbo. But we were all united for one common purpose. We might have different reasons for it, but everyone was doing the same thing for the same goal. I mean, well, we had 1,000 people in here at the end of the drive. Mr. Wizard, you know, when a few years ago, even thinking that anything like this would be possible would be something that couldn't, no one could comprehend. And I know for me personally, throwing it out there, when East Coast was dead and then some guy named Jay Fox was talking to this Alucard guy, was talking to the Scar guy about hosting one more tournament, a regional, and it ended
dude, that
up
was
being
so
like
funny. We like truly believed.
Events.
We truly believed in our hearts that Melee was dead,
dude.
It was
tournament, man. When we talking about Rom 1?
It was.
Yeah,
that's
yeah.
All me. I take credit for that tournament. Single-handedly, dude. That's all me.
Well, it was.
And we didn't get no hype compared to this.
It was a no yeah. Johns bi-weekly. I mean, I distinctly remember.
Yeah,
that
it was
a no
that.
Johns bi-weekly, and you said you were gonna fly out, and
I
then
said
all
I wanted
of a sudden,
to come. Thank you, King.
All of a sudden, Shiz said he was going to come. And after Shiz said he was coming, everybody was coming.
Yeah, it like started a chain reaction. Because there was like a $100 like out-of-state bonus. I'm like,
yeah,
I'm going to scoop up that $100.
That was it, dude.
I'm
going
to scoop it up.
I really feel like that was it. I don't know whose idea it was, but...
J-Fox put the $100, and then I was like, I'm there. Because I want to beat Meech King to shut everyone up. And then like Shiz went, and like Canada was coming, and like Lovage was coming. And then it was everyone
yeah.
coming. It's amazing. ROM 1 is a good experience for
yeah,
sure.
I almost forgot the Lovage game. Did you want to team with me, Scar?
He was the only one who cheered for me, dude.
I was like, no, dude, no way.
Oscar and Zoo, only the ones who had my back.
Can we team?
Yeah, and I mean, when was that? That was like beginning of 2009?
I think late 2009.
I'd be like 08, maybe?
No, I think that's too early, because Brawl came out in 08. March 08.
Oh, 08, 09 was Genesis, so...
Yeah, 09, right. Summer.
Let's look.
It was definitely, I think, November 08, I remember.
Let's just look when Shiz M2K4 was.
Yeah. But I think that's so amazing that...
Yeah,
because, I mean, Brawl, when that came out, was everything. Everybody dropped everything
yeah.
and started playing Brawl.
Yeah.
March
2009.
So... For that many people to come back to Melee, you know, it not only did it require, like, you know, you have to give up Brawl. Most people, they gave up Brawl. It also required you believing that everybody else was going to join into this thing and go back to Melee. So, I mean, I just think it's so fantastic that that actually happened. You know, it's in that period where everything was Brawl. And, you know, we just kind of grassrooted our game back up again a second time.
Melee won't die, man. It refuses to die.
Where's Neil? After you said after you said everything is Brawl, I just thought of all the Brawl and felt super mad. What
yeah.
were you gonna say, Mango?
No, remember that period of time when Melee was so dead? Oh, it was like, you'd get like 15 people at tournaments. Like, it was, after Brawl came, it was so bad. Oh. We were barely hanging on. And then we revived somehow.
Somehow.
Yeah.
Anyway, speaking of periods in Melee's history, why don't we pull in some guy who's working on a documentary, dude. It's amazing. So let's maybe he could talk to us a little bit about what he's learned in his journey. Travis, you there?
What's up, my man?
What is going on? Do you have
hey,
a webcam?
Dude.
I do. How do you turn it on?
There's like a button that has like a video.
A documentary guy.
What's up, Samix?
You're super big, dude.
What's up, man?
Hey.
It's good to have you on. Welcome to the show. This is Melee It On Me. I don't know if you've watched a few or every single one of them, but this is the whole extended cast.
Dude, I'm a big fan. I just have to say right off the bat, I was there with you guys when the arms were going up and the spirit bomb was coming in. Like, some of my cash went out of my pocket. So, yeah, big fan.
Amazing.
Awesome.
So, hey, we were just talking about, okay, so a big theme of this episode is we were talking about, like, community and, you know, when we felt like a big community, and a lot of the points that are coming around is like, hey, there were different eras in Melee where there were more, like, explicit goals for maybe players or for fans. You know, I just wanted to talk to you about, first of all, a documentary so you can, like, bump it, give the Melee It On Me bump. And second, you know, I guess, what are your thoughts? What have you seen? What have you learned?
Well, you know,
why don't you just start out by, you know, tell us about your documentary and what it's all about, what the timeline is, what you've got so far. Let's have everybody hear that.
Okay. Well, for those of you that don't know, I mean, I've been working on this now for almost 2 years. It started as a pilot episode back in the summer of like 2011, I guess. And just the reason it started was because my brother, and this might be true for a lot of people, kicked my ass at Melee. And I couldn't take that because he's my younger brother. And your younger brother, how are you going to let that stand? You got to get better and you got to beat him. So, you know, I mean, he after he beat me and we were kind of drinking that night too, he showed me these videos of, you know, KDJ and PC, and the level of skill was just so incredible. I had to kind of get involved. So when I went back and looked at, you know, kind of the timeline of the whole thing from, like, starting the beginning with Azen, Ken, and Isaiah, and then moving on to, you know, PC is this, like, big upset in New York, and he's the big guy then, and then it goes back and forth with MLG, is like you guys were saying, like, that was, like, kind of the golden era. And then there was that period where MLG kind of, like, fell apart, and there was, you know, you didn't really know what was going on in the community. That was a story to me. Like, as soon as I heard about that, how that kind of went, I mean, I just saw that, and I was like, this is so great. I mean, not only is it's kind of temporal, you have these guys that kind of, like, represent their eras, you know, like Azen in the beginning, and, you know, like, he's a fast guy, he learns quickly, picks up games really fast, and you know, Isaiah is just like this fucking, like, you know, I'm sorry, can I swear on this?
No problem, bro.
Okay, so I mean, Isaiah is just this magical being that
Isaiah
can win
brings
whatever
it out. Isaiah brings it out in people. Like, you could be civil all day, but then as soon as you talk about Isaiah, it's like, man, that motherfucker.
I mean, he really is, and you know, then Ken, of course, he's just, you know, ridiculous, and it's been kind of fun to see him coming back into the community a little bit now. But
yeah, I was gonna beat Scar, but
I was just watching that, but I hadn't seen that. I had not seen that until you guys were talking about it a little bit, Kings of Cali. But
should have been a best of three.
But yeah, you know, that it's a story to me, and that's kind of why I wanted to do it that way. These it kind of reminded me of Dragon Ball Z, to be honest. It reminded me of DBZ. You had, like, first it's Raditz, and he comes up, and he's, like, beats Goku, and then, you know, there's this other guy that comes in, and Piccolo, and, you know, all the Super Saiyan levels and shit like that. I mean, it moves through time, and you have these progressions of people that are really good, and they become the best, and then more people, like, beat them, and they become the best. So I couldn't not do something with that story, and to be honest, like, just kind of wading into this, is I wasn't, like, a pro or anything like that. I didn't have any major, you know, background in it except for just playing my brother. And wading into it, it was just, like, the community's been great. Like, after I made the pilot, everyone was super psyched about it. I raised, like, you know, $4,500 to make it, and everybody's been so awesome. So it's just been a great experience, and I will say, though, well, besides Azen, who is just, like, I can't get a hold of that guy. Mango has been such a hard guy. Or he was a hard guy to kind of get in touch with.
I gotta remain cool, you know. I can't just be all easy to catch up, you know.
No, for sure. I respect that. So, but you know, it was great. Like, kind of, you know, touching base with him at the Team Oxy tournament, and talking with Hugs too. And talking with Hugs, like, he kind of laid it on me when we were outside talking about how, you know, he was really kind of looking forward to this being like a cyber sport, you know, because he was saying how he couldn't maybe necessarily be like a basketball star, but he could be, you know, an athlete.
Basketball star.
But, I wish I could see that. Oh my god.
Imagine little Hugo just like dunking on some falling him up.
Oh god. But yeah, like he could be really good, like with his Samus, you know, kicking ass with Samus and winning MLG pot. So like that, it was just really kind of interesting to hear from him. So
amazing.
Yeah. So that where we are right now, I'm just kind of chugging away. I'm actually, this is how dedicated I am to making this thing great in the end, because in the, when all is said and done with these episodes, when they're all done, all I really want from it is to bring in people to the community that don't know these stories. And it would just be so great if in when, you know, at the end of the day, all like you were saying, Scott, earlier about the gaming community at large, how we all kind of have similarities. Like, I'll watch Call of Duty videos with, like,
right,
you know, idiots, you know, running around, like, doing crazy shit. And I think there is. There's a bond in the gaming community. I think that Melee, because so many people do play it, you know, they and Smash Brothers in general, I'll you know, throw that big net out there. Because, a lot of people have played Smash. And I think that net is big enough where you can bring people in if you have an interesting story. And I think the stories are interesting enough where we can do that. And you might see, maybe, hopefully, some residual boom in the Melee community specifically, because I'm going to lay it out here. I'm not really going to cover Brawl at all after this is done.
Oh, no. Poor no Brawl. Brawl's having such a tough day.
Well, I mean, you have to talk about how the release of Brawl affected Melee, obviously.
For sure.
So I presume,
for sure,
you know, that's a big thing.
Yeah. Absolutely.
But I think, you know, one thing that I really like about what you're doing is how often you keep everybody updated on it, because, you know, Smashers, you know, not the most reliable group of people. So, you know, once people heard about this, they might have thought, you know, this guy will work for a couple months and then it'll just, you know, probably
definitely
fall by
right
the wayside. He'll be, you know, too busy or whatever. But I'm really happy to see how often you've updated and how much new stuff there is. So I really hope you keep going, and I'm really excited to see how it all turns out.
Cool. Yeah, I mean, that was one of the things I noticed when I first kind of put out some tentacles, was that it was like there were already, you know, 3, 4, 5 potential documentaries being made. And I'm still curious. I'd love to see the one that I think got the most hype, or you know, I don't know. The one I was most interested to see was this one guy in Northern California, I guess, or
yeah,
San Francisco Bay Area. Did anybody know what's going on with that?
Is that Onsky?
Yeah. He works in the film industry now, and he's like a really busy guy. So yeah. I don't know how far along he is with that, because he's got a lot of other obligations.
It happens.
So I don't know. Yeah.
For sure. I mean, that, like you were saying, I mean, with the updates, I think that was important for me, because it wasn't something that you'd seen from Onsky or other people, that you'd have these, hey, I'm still working on this, I haven't forgotten about you guys.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, and, you know, that's what I'm hoping to do. And I'm taking the June, July, and August. I quit my job to put aside some money, so I'm going to be just kind of doing this and making sure that every last moment on screen you're at least enjoying a little bit. Like, the Smashers, I'm sure, will get every bit of it they'll enjoy, but, you know, even more, that broader audience to be like, hey, this is a legit sport, this is something that's really cool, you guys check out. So
yeah. So is Evo going to be, like, the end of the timeline for your documentary?
Well, you know, a big part of it, I think, is, yeah, it's kind of like Evo. Evo, to me, was the biggest crew battle win that you could imagine.
Mm-hmm.
You know, getting everybody in the Smash community on board. Seeing like little like tweets, I guess, from Jason Music Hang about, like, you know, we really want to get to Evo, stuff like that. Like that, him not being a really sociable guy too. I mean,
MGK went ham, dude. We'll never forget. Never forget the energy that came out of Music Hang during those 2 weeks.
I
yeah.
was amazed. I've
never seen him work so hard at anything. Oh my god. That must have been how he grinded versus the computers, dude.
Frog is still. Is that his prize that he has yet to claim?
No,
this one is mine, because he's actually finally received it.
Ah, okay.
Awesome. Yeah.
Nice.
Rest in peace. Miss those swords.
Oh, God. I remember those swords. I saw those.
So, Samax, what were you saying about, so Sheridan asked if that's kind of the end of the timeline.
Right. So, and this, basically the kind of, I regret not having more time and more money to kind of devote to Armada, and I'll say right here, he's not going to be a huge part of the documentary, unfortunately. Right. it kind of ends around Mango.
Amazing. Amazing.
So that's all I'll say kind of about that. But like, there is a wrap-up episode. I'm aiming for 9 episodes, two to kind of like, one to start about the game mostly, one to kind of bracket it to end it, and then the 7 about the guys, the main dudes that I kind of concentrated on. So, and the final topper, the end of it all is like, you know, we made it to Evo, we made it back to Evo.
Yeah, that's pretty sweet, dude.
Yeah.
If you need any kind of additional content too, we have some really funny stories out of all the guys.
Oh, so yeah.
If you're ever talking about somebody and you're like, oh man, I could use a really great clip of like a short story to really capture the essence of this character, you might just want to, you know, pose the question to this group, and I'm sure we can come up with something really amazing.
I think I'll have to do that. I really. You know, little bits and pieces, especially from you guys here, for sure.
Yeah,
absolutely.
I feel like there's some really quality stories about a lot of people, a lot of Smashers. Like, a lot of us are really weird, interesting characters.
I've collected a lot about MTK, but...
there's too many amazing stories about MTK. Go on, on and on.
I just realized that if the documentary ends with me and I win Evo, that means they would have just skipped out my 2 shitty years of Smash and just like, amazing, win Evo. And then it's like, whoa, Mango he didn't get raped at all. He was just amazing all the time. All right, I'm winning Evo. That's it.
That's it. There's the documentary. This is for the documentary, dude.
So that my legacy looks absolutely amazing.
There you go, man. You gotta win it for the documentary.
You gotta have like a tag. Yeah. We gotta come up with a sweet tag.
All right, let's do it.
Amazing. All right, Samox, dude, it was really nice to talk to you. If you ever want to come on and, like, you know, share anything or bump anything or ask for anything, feel free, dude. You're a friend of the show now.
I have a question before I go.
Yeah, please. Anybody, actually. Yeah.
I know you had the Kickstarter at one point, and I think that already reached its goal. Is there a PayPal or anything as well that people can donate to?
You're the man. You're the guy. See, what would I do without you, Prog? I still have I ran them concurrently. I wasn't too sure about Kickstarter or PayPal when I first did it. So I had the Smash Bros Movie @gmail.com. That's the PayPal account.
Whoa! Hold the horses. Hold everything. We got a raid. Good shit, Trihex. Thanks, bro. Woo! Dude, somebody in chat tell me how well Trihex did on his run. Was he doing a run today? I want to get the scoop. What's up, Trihex? Look at the viewers. Dude, he got the world record. That's it. World record.
What's up,
dude.
With it?
So, thanks for joining, guys. We're gonna let Silence keep going. So we're actually just talking about like the Melee community and a Smash documentary. And you guys just joined to hear the PayPal link. You don't want to donate any money. You came to the right place.
Now I'm curious. What did I miss? What is this? What's happening with Trihex?
Dude, you're not a Twitch regular, I guess. So
I guess
there's
not,
a thing called a raid where, like, when somebody finishes streaming and like all the viewers are just sitting around jerking it, you can redirect them to another channel.
Yeah.
So basically, Trihex was like, "Hey, everybody, raid Scar's channel. Thanks, Trihex. I love you, bro." What a homie.
Oh, cool. Well, yeah, if you want to have any free money, people who just joined us, the Smash Bros. Movie or gmail.com, you can just throw it down that hole. That's pretty good.
Amazing. Yeah, go ahead and link it in chat. It's moving too fast, but whatever.
Cool. So, yeah, I'd love to talk to you guys in the future, too. Really, like I said, I quit my job for the next June, July, August to do this. So.
We'll let you down, bro.
Yeah, we won't. Seriously.
Win Evo, brother.
I don't know. We'll see. Dude, it's so easy if I play good. It's like easy. But if I play bad, that's it. I just get fourth place. All or nothing. I'm all or nothing, dude.
We'll see.
You just gotta have eyes on the prize, Mango.
Dude, if I can stay focused like Little Mango used to, it's done. But I can't do it anymore. It's so
I feel
hard.
Like I don't know. There's something that there's a sense that I get in the community where we miss Baby Mango and we miss like Mutaking.
Yeah, Mutaking when he used to not be a baby.
Yeah. I miss old I miss Champion Mutaking. Like the
no, Champion Mutaking is the man for
he
sure.
He was so like I love cheering for that guy. I love cheering for him even more. Like the words of. The words of Green Goblin ring true in Spider-Man 1, where, you know, as much as everyone loves a hero, what they want to see more is, you know, hero to fail, fall, die trying.
Amazing.
That's right. I want to see Mutaking. But, like, I saw him fail, and now I want to see him come back. But, you know, obviously, you know, I'm not.
I think Mutaking's had the hardest drop-off for a Smash champion ever. He's had some hard times, man.
He did do stuff.
He hasn't won anything, and, like, oh, man.
But I can't cheer for him over the kid, but everybody else I'll cheer for him 100%.
Yeah,
dude, him versus Dr. Pee-Pee, I'll never scream so hard. That's like the set that I get the most hype about. It's Mutaking, Dr. Pee-Pee. I want Mutaking to win more than anything in my life.
For sure.
He's had the opportunities too, like
dude,
Game 5, FD.
Dude, if he's not such a baby, he wins that set, dude.
Yeah.
Twice now. Game
oh
5,
my God. At Apex, when he killed himself on that GIMP, I was like,
oh.
It's like Mutaking, you do that GIMP. In your sleep, that GIMP is free. How do you
right.
die?
Isn't that the funny
problem?
He's practiced that GIMP probably like 20 hours straight of his life has been dedicated to that exact situation.
Yeah, I don't get it.
Sucks.
It's like, dude, and like he upbeats, like, it's like, oh my God, I was so shocked. Like, he told me, like, dude, I did the worst SD. I'm like, it can't be that bad. I saw it and it was as bad as he said. I'm like, dude, that was the worst, like, oh my God. You can, he has a whole stock lead on FD. Like, that's done. That match is, like, probably over.
Yeah.
Nope. Nope.
Oh, well. Well, I'll shed tears after the cast is over. Samox, any parting words, bud?
Nothing. Just, you guys are awesome. I love your podcast, man. I'd love to be on again and talk more about the stuff I'm doing.
Yeah, so. Dude, thanks for tuning in. For your information and everybody else's, we're live like every 2 weeks, so mark your calendar.
Sweet.
2 weeks from now, it's May 15th, and we'll probably be live at 6 o'clock PST.
Dude, that I do my updates every 15th.
Dude, we could like do an event where we could sync them. Yeah.
We could.
Who, bro?
Do you want another special guest?
Dude, don't
James
creep
Chen.
Me out. Oh, let's
James
do
Chen
it.
Sets.
Let's do it. All right, Samus, I'm kicking off, dude.
What's your
dude, documentary guy?
It's good to have you on, bud.
Later, dude.
Thank
Thanks
you
for
guys.
Coming.
All right, he's gone. I kicked him so fast, I don't know why. That was a lot of fun, though. I'm glad that he came on.
Yeah, I mean, he's been working really hard, and I know, like, just talking to him, he's had a bunch of stuff come up. I mean, he was locked down during the Boston bombings and stuff. And this is still on his mind, so.
Yeah.
Definitely shows how much he's putting into it. So everyone definitely please show him your love, show him your support, order a copy of the DVD or the Blu-ray with special bonus footage.
So James Chen asked if it's too late, and my reply was yes! Exclamation point, add me on Skype. So I think that's a fairly ambiguous message. I meant to say no, add me on Skype, but unfortunately, oh well.
So
happened. So that's the end of that.
Are we playing CS after Star?
Yeah, for sure, dude.
Okay.
Yeah, I think we should talk more. You know what I think we should do while we play CS is we should talk more about the characters.
Like, oh yeah, if I'll stream it, if you guys want to come and chat about Melee, I'll be more than happy to talk about it while I play Counter-Strike.
Yeah, dude.
Also, Mango, would you be replying to your tweets at all? Or?
I don't know how to reply to tweets, but how do you do it? give me a brief. Give me the run through.
No.
Because if people tweeted me stuff, I'd be real happy to answer stuff.
Dude, on Twitter, are you watching the stream? Can you see the stream chat?
Yeah, I got it right now.
All
right,
so now I'm going to full screen over here. So this is my Twitter. All I ever do, like home, always moves too fast, and I never understand what's up. Connect will show you anybody who's... any interaction that you have with anybody, and if you just hit mentions, it's all the people who tweet at you. So then from here, you just hover over one and hit reply.
Oh.
That's it, bud.
So, wait, where's that at?
That's so when you're on Twitter, I would just go to @connect all the time. That's it.
Oh, I didn't know that button existed.
Yeah, bro.
That
is the win button.
What a world, oh my God.
What a world.
Look at everyone tweeting the kid.
Wait, you have a lot of sweets?
Look at that. 4-star homie box? Nice. That'd be great to come home and see that.
Yeah, man.
Alright, I'm on it now.
I hope that everybody in chat will get Twitter. Dude, Sheridan, can you share with me why you don't want Twitter?
What am I going to do with it?
Sheridan's just not a Twitter guy,
exactly.
I understand. It's cool.
I know, I understand too, but I really want him to do it because if we win Sheridan, we win everybody.
You're not going to get Sheridan. I can't see Sheridan making
it. I can't see it either, but like, I at least want to have the conversation and give it the old college try.
What? I don't have anything to say.
You know what you could do on Twitter? You could tweet and say, oh, there's a tournament. And then everybody will join it. Everybody will join the stream. And everybody will go to the tournament.
Somebody else can do that.
Yeah. Like, I mean, one thing that I really love is how
Showcase
out in France, how he updates people in bracket events, what event is going on, where the stream is, just basic stuff like that for TO and letting the general populace know.
I see. But,
you know what I think
know.
Would be cool for Sheridan? If you made a Twitter and, like, just posted, like, randomly, like, IQ of, like, 200 facts on your Twitter. And then
that
I would
be amazing.
Love to read it. It's like I learned a new thing about, like, dark matter or whatever today. Oh, cool. Retweet. Favorite. Whatever.
Well, I mean, there's plenty of Twitters that will give you cool facts.
But I want Sheridan's cool facts.
Yeah, exactly.
I want Sheridan.
And you know what's even better? You could just, like, watch all the scientists' cool Twitters, and then you can retweet the ones that are relevant to us that we should watch.
Well, you know, actually, what I'm most interested, just in general, about science isn't so much, like, individual facts themselves, but how you build up these facts to tell a story,
exactly.
A.k.a., you know, have a theory or a hypothesis. And that's, I don't think Twitter really is the right venue for something like that. Because I don't think you can, you know, an idea, ideas like that are just too rich to really be expressed in a series of 144 character posts or
right,
whatever.
Right, so here's the pro tip. You type like, hey, sup, found something dope, link. And then we check out the link, which has your blog or a talk. Dude, I would love to watch every sweet YouTube video that you watch and you'd love.
Yeah.
Anyway, we got James Chen. You guys ready?
Oh, okay. Yeah.
I'm gonna pull him in. I'm gonna pull a big guy in. He's gonna be eating. It's
okay.
Perfect. I'm gonna tell him a story too. Dude, I got a story all lined up, it's done. When I got stories, things get crazy. I wonder if he has a webcam. Wouldn't it be so funny if he's like, oh man, I don't have a webcam.
I do have a webcam.
What's up, dude?
Do you want me to jump on a webcam here?
Yeah, I want to see what you're eating, dude.
Oh, okay. Hang on a second. Let me see if I can get this to work.
All right. Oh, larger than life. What is up with it? You're on Melee It On Me. This is our podcast that we do every 2 weeks. We talk about cool stuff.
Awesome. Good stuff. Good stuff. How's it going right now?
I think that we're all having a great time.
Let me see if I can get my camera to work here. Video.
Well, this is too much suspense for you to handle. What are you actually eating?
I am eating some pasta.
Amazing.
Yes.
So actually, the
delicious,
one time...
Delicious pasta.
The one time ever that... my fiance's name is Sophie. One time her dad actually tuned into the stream. It was crazy. And it happened to be like a moment where I was eating... Like, on stream. So the next time I saw him, he was like, oh, hey, Bobby, you know. I didn't know that you were a celebrity or whatever, you know, being like an old dude. And he was like, you know, but you're so rude. How are you eating on the webcam? I was like, oh, I'm sorry, Mr. Dooman.
You can't do anything about it, man. It's like every time I jump on commentary at Wednesday Night Fights or something like that, they always see me eating on camera. It's like it's almost like an inside joke now that I'm always eating on camera.
Just brutal. I'm so hungry right now too. Really
so you can't see me still, huh?
No, that's okay.
Okay, I'll keep working on it as we go. So maybe I'll pop up all of a sudden.
Yeah, absolutely, man. So, yeah, I mean, we were just at NorCal Regionals. You know, it's sick to actually have the back and forth with you. You know, we were talking like a teeny tiny bit after the Evo donation drive. And
yes.
Then, you know, NCR, we were actually in the same room. And I mentioned on Twitter, I saw you pass me one time, and I was like, I kind of ran away a little bit.
So you should have ran up to me.
Okay, I had things going on, right? So it's like not like I just ran away, but I kind of just ran away.
No, man.
That's the story of NCR.
You should have just hit me up. You should have just been like, yo, what's up?
Well, yeah, and then you looked busy, and then I was kind of busy, and I was like, eh, I'll do it later, and then I didn't. So, yeah, we just wanted to chit-chat a little bit, you know. So we talked a lot about, actually, on this episode about just esports in general and how, you know, it's the opinion of a lot of Smashers. I mean, maybe it's mostly me, but, you know, we kind of feel like not only do we want to grow the Smash community, but, you know, we're interested in there's like a hierarchy, right? There's a Smash community, which is ours, and then we fit into the fighting game community more than any other kind of genre. And
right.
then, you know, the community of gamers is in general is something that we all feel like a stake in, and I, at least, really want to contribute to the growth of esports and the growth of, you know, sort of streaming video games and video game competitive gaming as, like, you know, a trend. I want to contribute to that in a meaningful way. And we feel like we have a lot of people in our community and we can, you know, really be productive. And so is a step in the right direction.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I mean, I'm sad that Melee was kind of off on its own room at NCR, you know, because I didn't get a chance to see it. And I was actually excited. I really wanted to, you know, check out Top 8 and stuff like that, but I didn't actually get a chance to see that. So I was really sad. But, I mean, yeah, I'm hopefully, you know, with it being at Evo and such like that, you know, again, I should clarify that this is the second time Melee is going to be at Evo. Yeah. So, you know, with it coming back to Evo, you know, hopefully a lot of people get a chance to watch it and really enjoy it. And that's kind of what, you know, what we were talking about on Twitter, right?
Yeah.
I really want to get to a point where we can get one of you guys on UltraChen TV and then you could explain like a match and, you know, the things to look out for and such. So, because there's so much subtle detail in a Melee match, you know, when you watch it, just like the precise movement and stuff like that, that I feel like a lot of people are going to be missing if they're not familiar with the game. So
yeah, for sure. And it was actually like super rewarding for me, and I'm pretty sure like everybody on this cast, at least when we watched your cast and you guys were talking about like the creativity in Melee combos, you guys were just kind of talking about like, you know, the open-endedness and like, oh yeah, these guys are, you know, doing crazy footsies and blah blah blah, and I was just like, yeah, they're talking about us.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, the one thing that I've always said about Smash that I love about Smash so much is, you know, a lot of the fighting games, you know, you have jump arcs, you jump a certain way. When you get hit out of the air, you have a certain reaction and stuff like that. Everything in Melee is completely analog, and so much to the point that as your damage increases, you know, you start flying further, and so there's just all this, you know, stuff that keeps changing in the game, and the movement of it is just so, like, variable that, I don't know, the game feels way more organic, and so there's something more, I don't know how to describe it, but it feels more alive to me in a way, you know? So it's not as exact, and that's the thing that I like about it.
Yeah. Not as exact. I like that.
I mean, I hate saying it that way because people might interpret that as a bad thing, but in my opinion, that's what makes it unique, and that's what makes it so much fun.
Right, there's kind of like a creativity that's kind of necessary. Like, there are, you know, and I actually wanted to talk about that during the NCR cast, because we were really trying to find out, like, hey, what do we need to explain to, like, make this a more natural viewing experience to people who aren't, you know, as familiar with Melee.
Mm-hmm.
And I kind of wanted to point out, like, certain combos are more like auto combos or scripted combos, and then others are, like, you can just tell it's like creativity. This situation does not happen twice, and you kind of have to you kind of have to make a few guesses to actually make this come together.
Yeah, that's like my favorite thing. Whenever you start watching people going for those edge battles, and all of a sudden, you know, they're just like, you know what, I'm gonna go down after him, and I'm gonna do this crazy thing and kill them. And it's just, I don't know, I get hype when I see it. So.
Well, we do too. Hey, so I had my one big question that I wanted to, you know, give the guys a chance to ask you whatever, but you know, if you have a few more minutes, I want to ask about, you know, what you see for like the future and how you feel, you know, if you have any advice for us as you know, we're an older community, right? We're pretty established, but we're definitely, you know, with the advent of streaming, you know, we're able to grow in a way that we haven't been forever. So, you know, just wanted to chit chat about that.
Yeah, I think it's kind of funny, too, because, you know, Smash still has this reputation that everyone who plays it are kids. You know, and this is a game that's been around for like a decade now, you know?
Yeah.
If you were playing it when you were 15, you're 25 now, you know? Yeah. So it's not like that at all. So I actually do agree that it's definitely an older community now. And
yeah, we definitely grew up with the game, dude. There's some people, some of us are pretty old, man.
None of you are as old as me, I can guarantee that.
I don't know, dude. Some of us will give you a run for your money.
I'm an old, old man. It's not because I don't think you guys are old. It's because I know I'm very old. But, no, I mean, I think it's really cool that we're getting Melee back into Evo. I've always been one of those people that, you know, forever has argued that Melee is a fighting game. You know, there's a lot of people who sit there and say, oh, this is not a fighting game or whatever like that. And it's funny, too, because, you know, I'm going to expose myself here, and you guys are going to, like, want to cut me off and, like, throw me out of this chat now.
No,
but
man, we're very understanding.
As a Melee player myself, I never played anything except for, like, time free-for-all with items on with my friends. You know?
No, you're out, dude. Yeah. You're out. This guy's out. Exposed.
You know, so I enjoyed the game, you know, in a completely different fashion than the competitive 1v1 Melee game. And even so, like, just I have such a fond appreciation for, you know, the kind of stuff that you guys do. And even though I played it as a party game, I totally see, like, the depth and the strategy and all the skill involved in the 1v1 matches. So, you know, I've had, like, arguments with my friends. They're like, it's not meant to be played that way. And I'm like, dude, why not? Why not? You know, it's a great way to prove if you're the best player at Smash Brothers, you know. And so I think it's cool that it's coming back to Evo. I think it's appropriate. And, I mean, look at me. Like, I'm still sitting here playing Super Turbo, which is like a 15-plus-year-old game, right? So I think it's awesome. You know, I think it's totally worth, you know, I think it's absolutely valid to have a game like Melee at Evo still being played, especially since your community is still so strong with the game. So I honestly hope that this will even help kind of, like, bolster it back up, like, get more people involved in it. And that's why I want to teach people how to watch the game, not even necessarily from a player standpoint, from a viewer standpoint as well, because spectators are so important for competitive gaming in general.
Yeah.
It's really, I mean, it's kind of weird because, you know, when we used to put on all of these tournaments and stuff like that, fighting games and such really was a player-oriented kind of thing, but now it really is a spectator-oriented kind of industry, if you want to call it. So, you know, if we can get more people watching Melee, I think that's fantastic. And, you know, if it can actually grow at this point, you know, despite being a 10-plus-year game, you know, year-old game, I think that'd be amazing.
I think that the, you know, the growth and the transition that you guys experience, you know, moving from a player-centric community to, like, really needing the viewers and, you know, really catering to them, that's something that we're kind of learning now. It's very new for us. We've never really, I feel like as a community, there are certain people who are at the forefront of that and really thinking about it. But, you know, we're definitely not at the level of a lot of fighting games right now.
Yeah, I mean, that's the trickiest thing about the games that we play is I feel like they're, like, really hard to get into. They're really hard to learn, you know?
Yeah.
Especially a game, you know, games like Guilty Gear or Marvel, you know, you just sit there and you play it and then some Magneto just comes and destroys you in, like, 2 seconds and you have no idea what happened. So, you know, I mean, as understanding that it's a spectator kind of thing, that's why I kind of do what I do, you know, with the shows and try to, like, I'm trying to teach, like, super. I have episodes where I try to teach people how to throw fireballs.
I watched that episode, dude.
Yeah, so, you know, I'm just trying to open it up to as many people as possible. So, you know, for the people who do watch it and enjoy it and they want to try it, then, you know. And that's actually one of the trickiest things is, like, if you sit there and you watch something like Smash Brothers and you have no idea what's going on, you're never going to be tempted to play it. Even when you're watching super high-level stuff, if you understand what you're looking for and if you understand where the strategy is coming in, that can increase the temptation for you to play the game. You know, so a lot of people may just watch this, and once they start understanding the strategy, they're just like, this just looks too much fun. I got to try, you know.
Dude, it's the itch. All the gamers know what you're talking about when you say, man, sometimes I get the itch, dude, I have to play.
Yeah.
There's nothing I can do about it. You watch a sick set, it's like, oh my god, I have to play right now.
Yeah, the hardest part, of course, is, you know, where do you get a GameCube from now?
Dude, I guess I took that for granted. Yeah, that's actually kind of tough. No, I never even thought about that.
Now here's a question. They haven't released, they don't have GameCube games on the Wii U, like for virtual console, do they?
Not that I know of.
Oh, man. Because the thing is,
if you do have a Wii, it is backward compatible.
Oh, that's true. The Wii U can play GameCube games, right?
I don't even know. I'm not sure that it can, actually.
Okay.
But I think, the Wii U has been hacked, so I'm pretty sure they'll be able to load up, an emulator on it eventually.
Right, right. Okay, well, I mean, at least if you have a Wii, you can still play it, right? So.
Yeah.
Wii's, the Wii. Amazing. Dude, and oh my god, I have so many questions, but I don't want to take all the time.
No, go for it.
Prog Share Dizzle.
What's up with it?
I have a question. Well, you did mention, possibly going over a couple of matches on UltraChenTV,
mm-hmm.
Which, by the way, you guys should be following on YouTube, Twitter, and on your Facebook as well.
Dude, we'll hook it up to you. Melee it on me, bump.
But what kinds of matches would you guys be most interested in us sharing with you? What are you looking for?
I mean, obviously,
for your audience,
hype matches would be really cool.
What gets you hyped?
Me? Oh, yeah. Just whenever people start jumping off the playing field and they get into that really edge air battle, that's like my favorite thing. And it's really interesting. Like, one of my favorite parts of Melee, honestly, is when one player gets really damaged and they're trying to get back on and the other player is like trying to cover all the options. So I love it when you see people like jump and grab the edge to edge hog, but then they're like trying to bait the guy to not go towards the edge, and so then they jump on the ledge, grab it, then jump back up and try to go and catch the guy while he's like rocketing in a different direction and stuff like that. That's my favorite part of watching Melee. I love watching that edge battle. So, and that's kind of the kind of match that I'm hoping to see. And you guys can correct me if I'm not even talking about the game correctly.
That
you know,
perfect.
You guys...
yeah, totally.
Perfect.
Okay.
I think that's
okay.
Great because even though Melee's combo system is pretty different from other fighters, that edge guarding thing is something that's quite unique to Melee.
Yeah.
So emphasizing, the depth in that aspect of the game, I think definitely is something that we should look for.
Yeah,
I kept trying to say it in the commentary too. Like, Melee is a game that's played at the ledge. You can hit somebody over and over, but if you don't get the kills, you're not winning.
Yeah, I mean, to me, like, that part is where the majority of the mind game starts coming in. Because then, just the. When you see someone who has high damage and they somehow manage to get back onto the stage like five times in a row and then all of a sudden start their own, start doing damage themselves, it's just it's fantastic to see. It's like every time you see that, you're just like, yeah, go, get excited about it.
Yeah.
And so honestly, that's kind of the matches that I would like to see is one where you can really see the high level mind games going, where you can see the players trying to bait each other into doing stuff, or where they're trying to preemptively predict where the opponent's going to move. And that's exactly what I mean by some of the organicness of the game. It's like, for example, if you're Fox or something and you do an up B, you can aim pretty much in any direction thanks to the analog controller, right? So what you end up is the situation where you really almost have like a billion different choices that you could go, or you could do a towards B to try to get back to the ledge or something like that. And so the opponent who's trying to do the edge guard has to keep all these options in mind and like try to trick the guy into doing the one that you want him to do. And I don't know, that part, that's what, gets me excited about it. So that's the kind of match I want to see, is a match where you see someone like doing really smart stuff, either to edge guard or getting like a down A to like get a spike kill or something like that, like with early damage, or somebody who just has like ridiculously high damage who manages to survive constantly and then gets his own kill or something like that. Because that's
we're doing Shazam 2K4. I don't care what you guys say. This is like one of the, in my opinion, the best match that's ever been played. Like, if you have one match that I would recommend to anybody to watch, Shazam 2K4. Every day of the week.
Yeah, I'm down. I'm down. So
I showed my fiance. I have to call her my fiance now, because I got yelled at last time. I showed it to her, and I don't want to spoil it, but I'll tell you. But you know, Shiz is up like 3-1 on MTK, and she was sitting there. She was like, "Wow, it would be amazing if this Marth guy actually comes back and beats him." I was like, "We'll see what happens." And I knew. I was like, "Ah!"
Nice, nice. No, actually,
it
Bobby.
Is kind of like.
Oh no! I just want to ask, where do you live? Are you in SoCal or NorCal?
No, I'm in NorCal. I'm actually on Stanford's campus.
Oh, okay. Oh, nice. Gotcha.
Yeah, I'm in Palo Alto. Work in San Francisco.
Nice. Okay.
As is Sheridan, who is also here.
I'm in Santa Cruz. Yeah.
Okay. So if we got you on the show, I'd have to like do some technology wizardry to do like video and Skype at the same time, which I'm.
Are you in SoCal?
Yeah, I'm in SoCal, so I'm terrible at technology.
That's okay.
Look, I love technology, but for some reason Skype is just like doesn't like I'm bad at Skype, as you can see, because I can't get the camera working, which is really sad. So,
dude, we'll figure it out. I don't know if it's depending on if I get the time off. I might just I love taking days off, so you might see me down there, Mango. I might be coming down.
Okay.
If you can come down like on a Monday or something, I would, or a Tuesday or something like that, I would totally love to have you, and you can stop by Ultra Chen Studios.
It might happen.
Which is just my living room. So
amazing, dude. So that leads into like the most important question that I actually had. So I've actually been thinking about, you know, committing to this kind of, you know, effort and like contributing in a more meaningful way. How are you living the dream? Are you don't have like your full-time job is FGC, right?
No.
I was hoping that it was a dream. I wanted you to say, man, I'm surviving off of this. It's tough, but I'm doing it.
It's the exact opposite
right now. No, you're killing me.
Basically, I always tell everybody I have two jobs, one that pays for the other one, you know?
No, that's what I'm doing. No.
Yeah. No, for example, NCR, I took Friday off from work. I flew out, and on Monday morning, my flight was at 8 in the morning, like 8:30 in the morning. I got back to SoCal, and I went straight to work. So, I have a normal 40-hour-a-week job, and I just try to do the FGC stuff as much as I can. You know, just it's more definitely still a love and still a hobby. So. Yeah.
Right. Is anybody doing it? Who can I ask that question? Who is the best person for me to ask that question to?
Some of the people who are actually doing it full time now, for example, are like Spooky, who does all the streams of Vi, you know, from Alex Vi from Level Up. Obviously, there's some players like Justin Wong and Filipino Champ and PR Rog who are pretty much, you know, pro video game players and such. So, but I am not one of them, not yet.
So we still got a ways to go.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I mean, that's the thing is like from my standpoint, and this is the thing. I mean, obviously, it's kind of interesting for me to talk about this because you guys actually were a part of MLG at one point in time, you know, but you've probably heard. I don't know if you guys have heard, but I'm always kind of like wary of MLG. You know, people know me as this guy who's like, I don't know about this kind of thing. And it's because for me, I understand that in order to build this thing, it's gonna be a slow process, and it's something that we really need to establish and create a proper foundation for. Like, I want to get to the point where the fighting game community can sustain itself,
right?
You know, because then nobody can boss us around. You know what I mean? No one, and you know, yeah. I mean, you guys are probably familiar with this, right? No one can say, you know what? You guys are not bringing in the numbers. We're dropping you. We're going somewhere else, right? Yeah. And so, you know, I'm doing everything I can to try to help this community grow as fast as possible, but I still know that it's going to take a very long time. So, you know, I'm willing to fight the good fight and keep going at a slow pace, but, you know, in the end, I think it'll pay dividends. It might not pay dividends for me in particular, but right. if I can help establish something that'll benefit the people, you know, the fans of fighting games in the future, I'm totally down for that.
Yeah,
so.
Come on, man. What is that's like the biggest dividend of all is like just dying with like a full happy heart, man.
Yeah, absolutely.
Dude, on my deathbed, I may never earn a dime, but on my deathbed, I'll be like, you know what? I made Smash. Like, I contributed to that. That was part of me, man.
Yeah, absolutely. So that's exactly how I mean, I've talked about this with other FGC members, like Mike Ross, for example. You know, we just look at each other and we're like, you know, you always have to have martyrs to be able to get these scenes up and running.
Yeah,
I mean, you think about all the people like in early basketball and stuff like that, like the first superstar of basketball, George Mikan, like he was poor for almost his whole entire life, you know, but because of him, he helped establish this sport, and now look at it, it's ridiculous, right? It's because of George Mikan that Kobe Bryant gets to make as much money as he does.
That's the way, hopefully that's the way it will be for me as well.
Yep, absolutely.
All right, man. Well, hey, so does anybody else have any big questions? No? Dude.
Final question, I guess. I know SRK did feature it, but have you seen the video done by Metal Music Man, which was trying to introduce Smash to the casual Street Fighter audience?
Yes, I did, and as soon as I saw that, I tweeted it out immediately. I thought it was a great video. I thought it was an awesome video. In fact,
it was fantastic.
I feel like I should tweet it out again as a reminder or something. Well, you know what? Once we do the Smash episode, we'll tweet it out again. That'll be a perfect opportunity for me to plug it as well, plug it again. So, yeah. No, I mean, that you asked me like what you guys can do to help grow the community and keep it growing strong and stuff like that. And it's stuff like that. Honestly, it's content creation. It's kind of educational material to help people. I've even told other people like in communities like the Persona community and stuff like that, you know, like make a video, teach your game in relation to Street Fighter. And a lot of them are just like, oh, you know, why do we have to gear it towards the Street Fighter players? And then Metal Music Man goes and makes exactly what I was telling them about, you know, it's perfect, exactly what, you know, I wanted to see, that kind of video. And that's why when I saw it, I was so ecstatic, and I just had to, like, tell people about it, so.
Awesome. Awesome. Well, you know, I know we, like, really want, we have the passion, we just need to continue to organize. I really do feel that, you know, we're taking a lot of concrete steps and getting to a really good place. But, you know, the execution is always tough because how great would it be to just have like 3 or 4 people who are dedicated to just making Smash grow? I would totally donate to that fund. I want to think about that, man. Just get
Kickstarter,
like,
man.
You know what I mean? Just give me like 6 months salary. Just let me eat and I'll do it. I'll work on it for 6 months. It'll be amazing.
Yeah. I mean, to be honest with you, that's what's going to do it, though. It's nice because you do have a pretty strong base. You know, a lot of the smaller games, like a Soul Calibur, for example, they just don't have the same kind of large fan base. But I know Melee has a pretty large fan base, right?
Yeah.
And you obviously have the people with the passion. And that's what's really going to drive it, right? As long as you guys are passionate. I mean, the best example, you know, I mentioned Super Turbo already. Kuropi on Twitter, aka Bob Painter, and a few other guys like Muffin Man and a few other guys who love Super Turbo to death. They're the guys who organized the ST Revival group. They're the ones who got that Tournament of Legends thing going last year at Evo,
Awesome.
Dude, I'll never stop talking about that. I like that, and the commentary for it was just, it was perfect for anybody that wants to learn about Super Turbo. Like, I showed it to everybody here.
He's been talking
about commentary.
He's talked about it at least 3 or 4 episodes. Every time we bring up commentary, he's always like, all right, you gotta check out.
Dude, yeah. me and David were so hyped for that. Like, it was like 2 a.m. and the two of us were just like, oh my god! You know? But, I mean, that is only a result of Bob Painter and Daryl, a.k.a. Muffin Man, and, you know, a whole bunch of other guys, DGV. I'm leaving out a bunch of names, and I'm feeling terrible about it. But, you know, they have a passion for the game. They're the ones who got that going, and they're the ones who are putting on another tournament this year, and, you know, they're keeping it alive. And it's that kind of passion that I feel like, you know, I mean, just because they have all this stuff going on, you see these Super Turbo side tournaments at all the majors and stuff. You know, they're not actually part of the major, but they're always there at every major because, you know, they are creating this foundation for the game. And I feel like Melee can do exactly the same thing, especially because you've got so many players who love this. And the other cool thing, too, is that you have your own personalities. You have your own players. You don't have to rely on Justin Wong to come and play your game or whatever like that. You know what I mean? You guys got your heroes and heels and everything like that. So it works out good. It works out great. I feel like Melee is primed, you know, to blow up again. So that's why I want to get people who watch it to appreciate it.
Love it.
Yeah, I think we're also lucky compared to ST because we don't have another game that's like too similar to ours.
Yeah.
You know, like ST, I feel like it would still be big if you didn't have another game that was, you know, just it plus a bunch right. of other mechanics.
So, well, I mean, how do you feel like that? How do you feel like Brawl kind of, you know, fits in here and everything like that?
Boring.
There's, I mean, there's really very little crossover in the Brawl yeah. and Melee communities now.
Okay.
A lot of people
I hate,
compare.
I hate watching Brawl.
Yeah.
It feels like the personalities, too, never really blew up like some Melee personalities. You know what I mean? Like the mm-hmm. drama behind Melee, I've always felt, maybe it's just because I wasn't really embedded in that community, but, you know, I've always felt like, you know, you mentioned heels. Like, we have distinct people who, like, you love to hate. And I don't know that Brawl had the same. Maybe they did, and I'm just ignorant.
They did, but, I mean, they were unrelatable, in my opinion. Mm. Like, there's a couple people that were known for, like, abusing every single possible instance of a
Boo.
Rule to get, like, you know, their free win. Things like that. And,
gotcha.
You know, it wasn't like somebody was just really good, but you just, I don't like this guy. I don't want to see him win, but he was just so good that you had to respect him. I mean, you didn't get too many of those people. Yeah. And, you know, I don't like to, they've done a good job with creating the community that they have with the game that they have, so I don't want to dump on them too much,
but
just, you know, there was, it was obvious, you know, half a month to a year within the game existing that just there was kind of a disconnect between the people who were playing Melee and the people who were playing Brawl.
Gotcha. Nice. I mean, what about...
A lot of people compare it to, like, the kind of disconnect between bands of Third Strike and the bands of AA.
That's a great comparison. Yeah, there's the Third Strike bands definitely do not cross over into Street Fighter 4 as much as a lot of the other games. So, but I mean, actually, my question is like, where does Project M fit into this? Like, is that actually like an official thing? Is it going to be an official thing, or is it still just, you know, a pipe dream kind of thing?
I mean, there was a lot of skepticism, I think, at the beginning, but everybody who's been developing it, they've been keeping at it for such a long time that I can't imagine that it's really ever going to go away. They're just doing a fantastic job with everything. I think the only question is, you know, how much interest can they get in it? I mean, yeah. I actually went to a Project M tournament last weekend and I had a fantastic time.
Nice.
So I just hope more people will show up to it. Is the only thing.
Yeah, I mean, also, I'm just wondering, like, if you guys tried to do a big Project M tournament, would Nintendo get mad or anything like that, you know?
No one knows, man. We've had, like, a pretty high-stakes Project M tournaments.
Okay.
You know, it's featured at almost all of our, like, majors. They haven't bothered us.
Well, you know, allow me one shameless plug, you know? My partner, Ultra David, he's a lawyer, you know. If you ever need any help,
dude, amazing.
You can just contact him. So.
Yeah, we definitely have to call
him. Yeah.
I was thinking it could be kind of cool to have more crossover, and it does feel like Project M is kind of positioned to be, like, if there is ever going to be a crossover, that's where, you know, we could really, like, start talking and start seeing similarities between our games and stuff. But I don't know. I feel like a lot of us are kind of, like, it's enough of a job to keep, you know, keep Melee. I don't want to say keep it going because, like, it's going strong, but, like, we're so invested in this kind of idea that.
It's hard to drive both games at once.
Right, exactly.
Yeah, totally understand. I mean, it's hard. I mean, the fighting game community right now for us, you know, from where my standpoint is, it's already difficult because there's so many games, and you guys, you know, only have two. Even just with the two, though, I totally can feel it. You know, you can, it's so hard keeping one game, you know, going as strong as possible when, you know, so.
Yeah.
The thing I always wondered is how do you, like, you guys that play so many games, when you guys go home and you get together to, like, you know, practice or whatever, how do you decide what game to play?
That's a great question.
Because it seems to be just like half an hour of staring at the games on the shelf and just like, you want to play this? I don't know, you know. I want to practice this guy, but
it usually depends on the people that are in the room. So if you just have more people who like Guilty Gear, Guilty Gear is going in. If you have more people who like Marvel, Marvel's going in. And you usually end up with a bunch of people who are just sitting there like, I don't want to play this game. You know? But otherwise, also the other thing that a lot of people do is they'll bring another monitor and you'll just have two setups. So you'll have the Cross Tekken machine on one end and the Marvel machine over there. And then you can kind of jump back and forth. Or the people who don't like the other game can just stick on one machine, you know. That's what typically happens.
Amazing.
Yeah, I mean, I've had group sessions where I've gone to and I'm just like, I want to play some Marvel, and they're like just playing King of Fighters, and I don't play King of Fighters, so I'm like, aw. Uh-huh.
Yeah. That sounds pretty tough, dude. Tough life.
Nah, it's a good problem to have, though. It's a good problem to have. So lots of good games is always a good thing. And, you know, I love the variety in it, and that's why, you know, I love having Melee, you know, a part of this whole entire thing. So, you know, I would love it if somehow Melee and the fighting game community proper, I guess you can call it, just like some, like if the divide between the two grows less and less over time, like if we could just get it to the point where Melee is part of the fighting game community, then I would be ecstatic with that. So
yeah, I mean, I think that the key to that is going to be just like having a common goal, and I feel like we do have a common goal, but like surfacing that, you know what I mean, kind of being in this fight together and like, you know, kind of more explicitly wanting to grow each other's communities. You know, I do feel like we have a ton of we have a really large player base, a really large fan base, and like we're super passionate. And I think that we would both be, you know, lucky to contribute to each other's numbers. Of course, you guys have more numbers, but
I mean, how many people? What was the max number that you guys got on the Melee stream at NCR?
NCR was like 5,500, but I feel like it was mostly non-smashers, to be honest. And at Apex, I feel like, how many do we get at Apex?
I think it broke 10,000.
Definitely
for
broke 10,000. I think it was like 11.
Yeah.
Apex was definitely in the 20s, maybe 20s.
Was it 20? No, it wasn't.
I believe it.
Yes, sir.
No.
I believe it. Yeah.
No way.
But you know what? I mean, that's important, though. So, I mean, a lot of it is going to be, you know, acceptance kind of thing. A lot of people out there are like, I don't want to play a fighting game with Yoshi or Mario in it or whatever like that.
Yeah.
But, you know, and that's why if you can get them to see the high-level strategy and get them to understand, you know, that, yes, you have Yoshi and Ice Climbers or whatever, but the game is so brutal. Like, it's, like, seriously, like, one of the most, like, messed up evil games possible. I mean, like, you like, if you like games where you can clown on people, then this is the right game for
that.
You know what I mean?
some people embarrass some people.
Yeah, so, I mean, if we can get people to understand that about the game and really appreciate just, you know, how brutal the game really is, I think, you know, we can try to get past that whole stupid Mario thing, you know, like, oh, it's got Mario, whatever, dude. It's a character. He has properties. He's awesome, whatever, so.
Yeah, for sure. All right, parting question.
Okay.
What do you think is, like, the special sauce of commentary? Like, what's the biggest lesson that you learned, and what made you, like, a successful commentator?
Well, I always tell people three things. The three main things to do commentators, I tell everybody the same thing whenever they ask me this question, is number one is have a thick skin. That is, like, the most important thing that you have to have as a commentator, because you are going to get shit on more than you've ever been in your entire life as a commentator. And I'm just going to say this right now. I don't have a thick skin, so sometimes it gets rough.
Oh, you know? No, that sounds terrible.
But, you know, over the times, you know, you grow a little more, you know, tough about it, so it's not as bad. But
and you learn not to look, right? I feel like that was the key for me. I have, like, a really thin skin.
Yeah, I don't read the stream now when I do commentary.
You can't, dude. It sucks.
Dude, if anytime you hear me all of a sudden go silent on a stream, it's probably because I read the stream chat and I got depressed. So it just happens, man. It's so bad. But, I mean, so for the actual advice, the two main things that I always tell people is, one is, you know, focus on the why and not the what. One of the things that commentators like to do, for example, is say, oh, that was a nice uppercut, or, oh, that was a really well-placed ledge guard. But they don't expand into it. So, like, if you see someone do a nice uppercut, then you say, oh, that was a great uppercut because he walked himself out of the opponent's jump distance into a particular range where he wouldn't be able to anti-air as well, but then backed into it, and the guy jumped, and so he totally baited him into jumping. You know, just kind of explain it like that. you know, so you kind of give people a better idea of why things are happening, not just what is happening. Mm-hmm. And then the last thing I always say is just the main piece of advice is be yourself. Like, perfect. I remember when I first started doing commentary, I was like, yo, I'm going to be like Yipes. I'm going to come up with all these cool things like Pringles and stuff. I'm going to try to come up with catchphrases, and dude, it was a disaster. it was like the saddest thing, and people are just like, what the hell are you doing? And so, I mean, my whole life, just playing video games and just being with my friends, all I ever did was make bad puns. And so, you know, I'm going to do commentary. I'm just going to make bad puns on stream because that's who I am. I apologize to people, you know, because they're horrible jokes. I know they are. But I'm just going to do it because I'm just going to be who I am. I'm going to do James Chen. I'm not going to try to be Yipes or something like that. So amazing. Develop your own style and figure out what your strengths are and run with that. So,
hey, can I ask, like, maybe you don't remember, but, like, what was the number one worst catchphrase that you tried to...
I think at one point in time, for some reason, anytime something happened, I would always say stuff like, oh, yo, we got uppercuts. Oh, yo, we got scissor kicks. You know, like, I kept saying that. And just,
we
like,
got people, blank.
Yeah, and people were just like, James, shut up. Like, stop it. You are not, you know, that kind of person. So I was like, all right, I'll make some bad puns instead. And, you know, that just worked out better.
Awesome. Well, dude, it was such a pleasure having you on. Thanks so much. You know, I hope we can continue to work together. I will keep in touch on Twitter. And, yeah, dude, I might drive down. I'm thinking about it. That would be awesome.
Oh, yeah, dude. I mean, I would totally welcome it. I would love it, actually.
Drive down on a Sunday, show up on a Monday?
Yeah, absolutely. I'm totally down because, like I said, I really want to help, you know, the this side of the fighting game community, I'm gonna say it that way, this side of the fighting game community really learn to appreciate Melee and all the subtle nuances and stuff like that. So
this is for you, dude. That's for you.
Well, I'm doing it back, but you can't see. So
no, I can't. It's so depressing.
I can totally lie about it. I'm like, yeah, I'm giving you hearts back. Exactly.
All right, dude. Hey, man, have a great night. Do you have any shout outs? Yeah. Anything you want to say to anybody?
I mean, if there's any Melee players who are interested in getting into, you know, the fighting games, like on the Capcom side and such like that, you know, just check out UltraTV.com and, you know, you can get links to our broadcasts and stuff like that from there, all the info, or just follow us on Twitter at UltraChenTV.com, twitter.com/UltraChenTV, and you can follow me at J Chenzor as well, so.
Amazing.
Yep.
Good, man. Thanks again. Have a good night.
Hey, no problem, man. Thank you for having me on. This was a lot of fun. So.
Absolutely.
All right.
All right, later, dude.
Peace. Later.
Nobody can hear you, Prog. Your face is pixelated. You look horrible. You sound worse. Yeah, that's basically what you said is summarizes everything. You sounded like this. Watch. That's what I heard. I'm about to kick Frog. Cactus, Mango, are you guys here or what?
Yeah.
I'm here, just listening.
What's up, guys? Well, that was a lot of fun. We went way over, so I'm inclined to...
Whatever.
I'm inclined to call it a night.
Yeah, me too. I'm hungry.
Yeah, dude, I'm
I want to watch the rest of the Sharks game.
I'm super hungry.
Aaron's got things to do, come on.
All right.
I don't have that much to do, but
well, yeah. Let's say you want to do a quick round the rosy, and we'll end it on that.
Yeah.
So I can start. Hey, thanks to the stream, you guys did it. I think that maybe even just saying, hey, let's could we like tweet it out or whatever. We got maybe double the viewers that we usually do. We're usually hovering around like between 80 and 110. This whole time we were like at 180 to 200. And then thanks to the homie Trihex, we're up to like 282. What's up, Trihex? So yeah, thank you guys for watching. I wish that we could have done more call-ins. Maybe we can like next time just do like call-ins. I actually really enjoy the 1 hour show when we do like a ton of call-ins. So yeah, big hearts to our community. And what was I going to say? Oh, I would love to do more like, shouting out of, you know, of, cool stuff that we're doing. I'm not sure what the tournament landscape looks like right now, but, you know. Yeah, let's get on that. Does anybody know if there's any big tournaments coming
up? There's a SoCal tournament, not this weekend, but next weekend, that's pretty big, isn't there?
that Champ's hosting.
Yeah, it's like a $500 pop bonus for no reason.
Yeah.
So I guess I'm going to that.
We got the NorCal Alameda tournament this weekend. Don't forget Toriyukin. Only last chance for EVA points, I believe. And I don't know when that is, but it's in Toronto. And there's also Zenith.
Amazing.
So that's what's the near future for us.
Prague says, thanks for tuning in. Shout out to James Chen and the Melee production team. I would love to see an update from the Melee production team at any time, really.
Oh, yeah, and we got the Deep 3 this May 18th.
Is that really happening?
Probably.
I've won 50% of the Deep tournaments.
The Deep 3 Depthening intensifies.
Amazing. Yeah, shout outs to Samox. Shout outs to James Chen. Thanks so much for coming on. And yeah, thanks to my co-casters, Prague, Mango, Dr. Z, and Cactus. Do you guys want to say anything before we break?
I love all of you. That's
yeah, it was
all.
A fun show. And we're going to play CS now, if anybody wants to come hang out and chat.
Yeah, we can raid Mango, and we'll talk about, we're going to talk about some characters. I really want to talk about characters in Mango.
I just remembered what I wanted to ask Mango about, but I guess I can wait till next time.
No, I want to hear it. Let's do it. That'll be the parting thing.
I think it's a long topic, though, because what I wanted to talk to him about is, going into EVO, what does he think about his competition?
Me? Like, overall?
As individuals, the players that you're going to have to play against, the most likely, like, candidates to give you a challenge, what do you think of each one of them individually? Because we always say, like, oh, everybody else, but we don't, like, specify who we're talking about or, like, what we actually think about them or what their capabilities are.
I'm not too worried about any of them. Like I said, if I play good, everyone's really easy, and if I play bad, I lose. Like, that's it.
Yeah, but I don't want to say, I'm just going to rape everybody. I want to, like, ask you specifically, like, one at a time, like, your thoughts on each person. But again, I think that's something
We could save it for next time. That'd be fun.
Yeah, I think that's a big topic that we could talk about.
Yeah. I'm down for that.
All right. Well, and that's that.
All right, guys. I think I'm going to enter Super Turbo at EVO. It's not an official game, but it's a side tournament. So if anybody wants to join me in my journey to enter Super Turbo and win at least one match, then let's do it.
Amazing.
I'm going to play Cammy.
That's so
funny. You would. You would.
Awesome. Yeah, we should definitely all watch each other. All right, so are we going to raid Mango? If you guys want to stay with us, so I'm signing out for Melee at Omni. Yeah, if you want to keep with this conversation, navigate on over to www.twitch.tv/idestroypp69.
Yeah.
Amazing Twitch ID. All right, guys.
All right, later, guys.
Peace.
See ya.
Was a fun episode.
Yeah. Thanks again to all the homies. Da 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 da.
Out of here.